This is Noriyuki Wadarai, and you are listening to Pixelated Audio.
Welcome to the show. I'm Brian, this is James, and you're listening to Pixelated Audio, a bi-weekly video game music and retro gaming podcast.
Thanks so much for joining us today. In this episode, we're going to be playing music and talking about Lunar the Silver Star on Sega CD and its remake, Lunar the Silver Star Story, on PlayStation.
I am so excited to do this episode because Lunar is such an important game to me, and we've been talking about it for ever since we started the show. We're like, oh, we got to do a Lunar episode one day.
Oh, yeah.
It's got great music, and I think it's going to be a lot of fun to go through.
Unfortunately, RPGs are a little bit more difficult for us to do, so we're really overdue on doing one. So we decided, let's jump back in and not put so much pressure on ourselves to complete the games or get super far. And plus, we don't want to really ruin the story for anyone else since these are story-based games.
Right. That was a big part of it. We didn't want to over explain the story and all the major plot points, because that's something you should experience, right?
Right.
And really, focusing on the release and how it was important to, people at, 1999 or 1992, 1993 when it came out is more important than actually, going through the whole story and really diving into the meat of the game.
Oh yeah, 80 hour games, 80 plus, those are hard to break down into a single episode anyway. Plus we have so much music, which is always difficult to pare down because it's so amazing and you just want to play it all.
Yeah. We're also going to briefly touch on some of the other releases of this title, but our focus is going to be on these versions since they're the most well cherished amongst gamers, and personally we both have some kind of strong feelings attached to them as well.
Yeah, and there's other amazing games in the Lunar series like Lunar 2 or Lunar Eternal Blue, but today's topic is going to be on the first game just because, Lunar 2 really should be its own full episode anyway.
Yeah, this game alone, just all the music that we had kind of lined up is way too much. It's going to be really hard to pare this down.
Oh yeah.
And we already have probably way too much music already. So
yeah. And it's going to be a special episode anyway. So
I think so. And then also let's not forget Dragon Song on the DS, because that was another Lunar game that actually takes place 1,000 years prior to the first one. So there's a few in the series that we need to look at eventually.
Yeah. DS is another series we need to touch on pretty soon.
Yeah. It's been since Locke's Quest. It's been a while. Lunar to me was very important because it came out on the Sega CD, but I actually played the PlayStation version first. I had the Sega CD version, but I really hadn't gone through it and completed it. And on PlayStation, I remember seeing ads in different magazines, full-blown screenshots, these animated characters, on the screen with all this action and stuff going on. And I was a freshman or a sophomore in high school. And this game is kind of a weird nostalgia important kind of thing to me, because this was the time that my best friend at the time, me and him played a lot of games together. Dusty, he's been on the show,
and he actually played a track from this game on the show for our Extra Life episode.
Right. He had moved. It's the worst thing as a kid for your best friend to move away, right. And so he had just moved, and so we were back in the day, you didn't have cell phones and stuff, so it was we were calling each other talking about this game coming out. We both picked it up at the same time, even though we weren't living near each other anymore, and we were playing it through, and we would talk to each other every day, oh, did you get to this part yet? And we pretty much stayed through together the whole way through the game. And so it kind of has that extra importance. He had just moved away, and I was, kind of missing my best friend and all the times that we got to hang out. And so this was a way for us to kind of still talk about something like we were still next door neighbors,
Yeah.
So it was a big thing for me.
Yeah, no, I could definitely see that really impacting your memories of this game and how important it is. This is a highly emotional game that, has touched so many different people. Unfortunately, like most of the games we talk about on this show, I've never played. I wasn't really into RPGs as a kid.
Right.
I got Final Fantasy VII, was like, oh, what's the big deal? I don't really get it. And so I kind of glossed over a lot of this, but I am playing it now. I've actually been streaming a little bit of it on my Twitch, which is at Man Over Mars. So I do plan on completing this entire game probably on stream. So if you've never played it, you don't have the means to play it, but still want to kind of see it.
And experience it. Yeah.
Instead of like in a playthrough where everyone knows exactly what's going on. Like I get lost and like don't know what's going on, which is fun.
It's been kind of nice too for me to watch you stream it because I get to kind of see how... you know, somebody who has no experience with the game kind of going through it and see your reactions. And also for me, I get to kind of relive some of that stuff.
Right.
You know, I tried to play through a little bit of the Sega CD version and the PSP version just, you know, for this episode. But I've already played them both at this point.
Right.
Well, the Sega CD and the PlayStation version. So watching you go through it was a lot of fun for me because I can kind of see like, oh yeah, I remember how like I felt when like this happened, or like, you know, getting confused in this section, or like, oh, I got to go back here. You know, it's kind of cool for me to kind of relive it through your stream. So it's awesome.
Yeah. And the 4 or 5 hours that I've put into the game, I mean, it's really been a lot of interesting emotional feelings that have been going on. Like there's high points and low points, and I can't really compare it to too many games that give you that quality. And we're going to get into some of that stuff later, but I mean, it's a game that's already kind of touched me just in the beginning.
Yeah, you know, and the one thing I want to bring up is that there were quite a few people watching your stream of this.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed something, and I'm not sure if you noticed this, but like every single person that joined in the stream made a comment like, wow, this music is great.
Yeah, usually one of the first comments they would make would be like, wow, the music, or you know, crazy music.
And see, I don't know if that has something to do with like they know you host a VGM podcast. Yeah, so probably that.
It's possible.
But I mean, every time that somebody would come in, the music was totally rocking. So we got a lot of fun stuff to go through today. Let's go ahead and jump into the episode, the meat of the episode, and talk about the game.
Yeah, Lunar is quite a beast of a game. Originally, Lunar the Silver Star was published by Game Arts for the Sega CD in Japan in 1992 and in the US in 1993 by Working Designs, developed by Game Arts and Studio Alex. Because of its popularity, it was re-released, or basically completely remade.
Yeah, so in 1996, Game Arts completely reworked and retold the story of Lunar by releasing Lunar the Silver Star Story for the Sega Saturn exclusively in Japan. Then a year later, in 1997, an updated version of the game was released that made use of the Sega Saturn's MPEG card to support higher video quality. So it was like this card, attachment card, that you could pop in your on the top of your Saturn, and it gave you the ability to have a lot more video memory, and you could process a lot more and get, you know, see full screen animations and stuff like that. It was really cool. And this was the version that made its worldwide release, debuting on the Sony PlayStation in 1998. And then here in the US in 1999, the game was titled Lunar, the Silver Star Story Complete. And this time around, it was published by Kadogawa Shoten, ESP, and Working Designs for the English-speaking crowd. And even had a Windows release the same year, but Japan only.
Yeah, and Game Arts knew they had gold on their hands. But I think the timing made it a little bit of a hard sell for some people because a lot of developers had moved over to developing 3D titles.
Right.
And this just kind of missed that transitional window for games that were, you know, going from sprites to polygons.
Yeah, well, you know, not only 3D, but making use of other art styles and other technologies, right? So like Final Fantasy VII has ugly as sin 3D models.
Right.
I mean, anybody who tells you otherwise is lying. But it had these really rich pre-rendered backgrounds. It made you just kind of forget about the 3D modeling altogether.
Right.
You know, they were so vibrant. They're so beautiful. And they had so much thought and like emotion in them that everything else just didn't matter.
Right. You know? All that detail and life and character got brought into those ugly models. Like I remember playing Resident Evil and Resident Evil 2 and stuff like that. And they have all those pre-rendered backgrounds and it's like, oh man, this is so realistic. And you just forget that the models are not that realistic.
Yeah. Yeah.
But one thing that this game, Lunar, the Silver Star, had going for it was the amazing animated cutscenes.
Right.
I mean, they were insanely beautiful, top notch. I mean, they weren't just slapped together.
Yeah, no. And to be fair, when you combine those with the 2D, even though it's maybe a little bit in the, you know, right outside of that window, expressing a story in 2D, like a deep story in you know, sprites mm-hmm. can still be really engaging, really comfortable for people. You know, growing up with like the Super NES or the NES or Sega Genesis, you know, having a medium that we've already experienced, like, you know, beautiful, rich stories in, I think it still works.
Right.
You know?
I mean, even at the time, they were transitioning to a new technology that was all the rage. And 20 years later, or nearly 20 years later, we've seen that 2D sprite games are still very much loved and played and still being made, well, which is really great.
It's the new hot thing now. You know, it's like, you know, going back to sprite stuff. You know, yeah. Everybody wants to make sprite based games now. All the indie stuff is all sprites.
Yeah.
And then we'll, I'm sure in like 5-10 years, we'll see low poly coming back.
Right. So now, I mean, this game transitioned to modern day really great. You can go back and play this game now and it's still gorgeous and fun. Mm-hmm. It really makes you think of retro, and it has those amazing cutscenes just to spice it up even more.
I agree. So the developer Gamers, we've talked about them before.
Right. They were on our Alicia Dragoon episode, which I think was like episode 75 or so.
Yeah. It was what? Just a few months back.
Yeah. Right? It wasn't that long.
Yeah. So they were a Japanese game developer and publisher that was created in 1985 in Tokyo, I believe.
Yeah. And they had their hand in developing and co-developing some amazing titles like the Silphid series, Alicia Dragoon, which we just mentioned, and it came out just a few months before Lunar the Silver Star.
Wow.
And they also did other games in the Lunar series as well as the Grandia series.
Yeah, which you're playing right now
as well. Yeah, that's another set of series that I'm working on.
Yeah. So Studio Alex, really interesting little company. They were a Japanese video game development firm functioning primarily as a consultant company for other game developers. It was founded by Kazunari Tomi, a former employee of Nihon Falcom, who worked on a few different titles for the company. There was Sorcerian, Star Trader, and Dinosaur. I'm not familiar with Dinosaur at all.
Yeah, neither am I.
I can't. Maybe I know it. Maybe I don't. I don't know.
Probably be pretty fun, though.
Yeah.
I like dinosaurs.
So Studio Alex developed the initial three titles of the Lunar series with Game Arts as their co-developer and their co-publisher. And then in 2003, I guess they got into some lawsuits with Game Arts and lost, which eventually drove them to bankruptcy.
It's sad. It actually sounds like the plot of a RPG, maybe, like two brothers that once loved each other and now fight to the death.
Yeah, Cain and Abel. Man, yeah. that's sad. But anyways, it was an interesting company that developed some really great stuff that we can appreciate today. And I think it's an important part of video game history. Studio Alex, big time.
Oh, yeah. And the publishers in this game were also very top notch and had a lot of cool stuff going on. Mm-hmm. In Japan, there was Game Arts. And in North America, we had Working Designs, which we did talk about Working Designs before on our Potful Mail episode.
Which was a lot of fun to do.
Oh, yeah.
We played all sorts of music from all sorts of platforms, but what a great game.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think that was in the 40s, and it was episode 44.
Yeah.
And that's another game that has amazing story, such fun, playful banter, which Lunar does have as well.
Yeah.
But Working Designs was an American game publisher that specialized in localizing Japanese RPGs, strategy games, and top-down shooters. And it's published a bunch of cult hits, but it's probably best known for their work on the Lunar series. And in the 90s, they were one of the few companies that really wanted to take down that cultural divide between Japan and North America, basically bringing an eclectic mix of games and letting the North American audience have a choice whether they like them or not.
Yeah, we would never have seen this game had it not been for Working Designs.
Yeah, and I'm sure other companies followed suit, and we've been blessed with so many Japanese games that probably wouldn't have come out back in those days.
Yeah, I can't even begin to explain or describe how important the company was to, you know, video games today. I mean, like, they spawned a generation of gamers who wanted to see more Japanese cult hits, you know, mm-hmm. like who were more excited to see what was coming from overseas, because otherwise we wouldn't know, you know? And so I think it was a good time, and, you know, applause to Vic Ireland, because without his dedication, we wouldn't have had a lot of things that I experienced and changed my gaming life, I think.
Right. And I don't have to learn Japanese to be able to have them change my life.
Right. But yeah, best well known for their translations. Their packaging is incredible.
Top notch.
Yeah. For example, Lunar the Silver Star Story Complete was originally released as a limited collector's edition. And this is the version I bought mm-hmm. when I pre-ordered it Funko Land back in 1999. Went to go pick it up. And I just remember being blown away by, like, the box. I was just like, oh my God, like, really? I get all right. this for $60? I can't believe it. And yeah. $60 was a lot for a PlayStation game back then.
Yeah.
I think most were retailing for like 40, 50 bucks, maybe 50 bucks.
Yeah. Well, I mean, these games are one of the few games that seem worth the extremely high sticker price that they have now to pick up.
And they had to raise the price to justify the cost, because inside you had both game discs, you had a CD soundtrack, which is incredible, a hardbound color instruction manual, which is like a book.
Yeah.
It even has like the tassel, the red tassel.
A little ribbon.
It's like a Bible, man.
So, yeah, so you can remember what page you're on.
It's gorgeous. It came with a cloth map of the lunar world, and it came with a making of disc. And the making of disc is something, after you listen to this episode, go and go on YouTube or something. You can find the making of disc. Mm-hmm. It's out there. Somebody put it on YouTube, and it will give you so much more appreciation for not only working designs, but just what went into Lunar in general, like all the efforts and all the connections that had to be made from multiple people.
Right. Yeah. You could see the passion that everyone had, from, you know, Vic Ireland and everyone at the top, all the way down to animators, people designing the game, and even voice acting.
Yeah. And it's funny because Victor Ireland has such a influential way of speaking about the game, because he's really passionate. Seriously, I wish I could have been Victor Ireland. But anyways, he also was lead translation. He did all the scripting and everything like that. He was basically in charge of so much for the company. So really, we owe that guy a ton.
Yeah, it was just amazing watching the difficulties they had translating it from English or from Japanese to English and getting it to fit in the memory and all that stuff. I mean, it was just really cool.
Yeah. The making of disc also, I remember we talked about this on our Extra Life episode. But so the making of disc included this Easter egg.
Oh, yeah.
Of a game based on Atari's Warlords called Lords of Lunar. And you get this code while you're playing the actual game. You're playing, you know, Lunar.
Mm-hmm.
And they say, hey, you know, pop in the making of disc and put in this code or do this button combo, and you can play this like little mini game.
That's so cool.
Totally cool. And that's like Working Design's little special bonus thing.
Man, people used to do such cool stuff back in the day with games.
Yeah, even with all the limitations and, you know, CD platform, you can't do updates or anything. You just have to kind of map it out in your mind ahead of time.
No DLC.
Anyways, we've got a ton of music today. Now that I think about it, probably way more than we should have put in this episode. It's going to be quite long. But let's go ahead and jump into some music. This is Toward the Horizon for the Sony PlayStation, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
You just heard Toward the Horizon, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare for Lunar on PlayStation.
Yeah, this is obviously, it's kind of harkens back to the theme of Lunar.
Right.
If you haven't played the game, then you wouldn't know that. But that flute is playing the melody that we would normally hear vocalized in the beginning. So it's really cool.
Yeah, no, that flute is really beautiful. It feels like you don't hear too many flutes outside of RPGs, so it's nice when we get into some RPGs that we get to hear some different sounds that we're not really used to.
Different instruments and stuff, yeah. This song has kind of like this innocence to it, you know? It's like you hear this before you start on your journey. There's a lot of power and a lot of emotion, I think, in the beginning, that those really, you know, powerful hits. But then when the flute comes in and you hear the melody, it takes this kind of like humble approach, and kind of, I don't know, for me, it it makes me feel that there's something yet to come. I have so much to explore. And,
right.
You know, I'm just in this like innocent child's mind, you know, for starting an adventure. I'm so young and I have a big journey ahead of me.
Yeah. I mean, there's going to be plenty of boss music and stuff like that. But right. It is, I wrote down that I thought it was very upbeat and energetic. And I do think that it does sound kind of innocent and kind of like you don't really know what's coming yet.
Yeah. I can't help but like sing the lyrics to the song like
yeah
as it's
playing. I was doing so, that too
yeah
so. The lyrics that I know I yeah. don't know the whole song but
oh man I like recite it like on my way to work sometimes yeah. But let's talk about Iwadare for a little bit. Very awesome composer.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Amazing. Noriyuki Iwadare is a very well-known musician and famous for his work on series like Lunar, Grandia, which is another RPG, another JRPG that we talked about that's very well-loved. There's Langrisser, which is a tactical RPG, and Ace Attorney, which, if you haven't played, is like a visual novel in a courtroom setting that's an adventure game, which... may not sound like the most exciting yeah, game,
nothing,
but it's...
Nothing about that description sounds fun
right.
like on paper, but it's actually really good.
Oh, yeah. I hear people talk about the Ace Attorney series all the time. I haven't played it myself, but I've heard many people list it as some of their favorite series ever.
I played the first one. It was incredible. Long, long time ago. And all of these games have incredible soundtracks, and they're all well-loved for them.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, so Iwadare-san started working at a company called Cube in 1990, and he wrote music for 1991's Langrisser, which has this really great rock flair, heavy beats, that had some changes in the music based on the suppressing or opposing forces in battle, which is
awesome.
Yeah, it's really unique. And then a year later, when he did Lunar the Silver Star, his career skyrocketed, and he received all sorts of accolades. In 1993, he joined another company called 2-5, along with Isao Mizoguchi, originally a Cube member as well. But he was the sound producer, arranger, and lyricist for Lunar the Silver Star.
Oh, yeah. And Iwadare also assisted on non-composing roles on Sylphide, Ranger X, and Crusader of Senti.
Yep. A phenomenal composer. And he just has this ability to tie in so much emotion through his music. And the fact that we're going to chat with him later is just... beyond me.
Yeah, I still cannot believe that he agreed to be on the show and talk about this game, especially this game. It's yeah, just amazing.
He was very excited to be on. So, you know, it's one of those things, you know, we talked to some composers that we have experience playing games from years ago, back when we were kids, but it's like the music for this game had such a profound impact on me that, you know, being able to chat with him about some of the challenges or some of the interesting things that happened during the compositions is going to be a lot of fun, I think.
Oh, yeah. All right. So since we have so much music to go, let's back it up a little bit and start from the beginning of the game where we're introduced to a small farming town, which is home to the heroes Alex and Luna. This is the town theme of Berg from Lunar, the Silver Star story on the PlayStation.
Heard the town of Berg from Lunar, the Silver Star story complete on the Sony PlayStation, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
What a sweet, sleepy little track that's, you know, so full of like character and life. I really like this one a lot.
There's no way you could live in this town and not just be consistently smiling.
Yeah.
You know, it's like just like this happy, feel good innocence. You know, this is more innocent than that first track we heard. There's something about this track too that just puts a smile on my face, because this is really when you just start out. And I think when I completed the game, I went back to Berg and I heard this again. It's like nothing's changed.
Yeah.
They're still doing their thing. It's just, it's really nice. And then again, really pretty flute. And then when the guitar comes in, that steel string guitar, everything kind of unfolds and it feels like this growing, just breathing city.
Yeah.
Or breathing town.
Yeah. I noticed that when that instrument comes in, it kind of blossoms and the track kind of picks up a little bit and gets a little bit more energy and a little bit more life built into it, which I liked. It was a nice little surprise, because just even the beginning part, if it just kept looping, that was really nice and sweet. And it kind of tints when you talk to the NPCs and stuff like that, like, oh, you're probably a really nice person, and oh, this shop is really cool, and I liked going to the cow, there's that cow and you can make it move. But the town was just such a small little place, and that music just was so nice.
Yeah, it just fit really, really well. I think he did a good job with capturing how that town would sound if it had a theme.
Yeah.
Now, we've been talking about the PlayStation with the last two tracks, but the Sega CD actually has completely different music. Mm-hmm. And it was originally composed. It had, you know, a number of tracks. Everything was completely redone for the remakes. And so we're going to listen to another track. This is also Berg, but from the Sega CD.
Right, that was the Sega CD version of Berg, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
You know, it's a little more curious. Like,
I can see that.
A little. It's still innocent, but then it builds into something a little more grand,
mm-hmm.
which is a lot different than the PlayStation version of Berg, because
it
feels like a lot bigger than it is. But you can see the imagining or the imagination he had when he was composing the track for what Berg was in his mind, I think. Yeah.
Right. And I think I really like this track. I think it's a beautiful track. It's very still kind of friendly. It's a little bit more punchy. Some of the notes are a little bit more heavy hitting, especially with like the cymbals and stuff. It does get very grand and kind of regal feeling, which felt like maybe it should have been for a bigger city than Berg.
Right.
Berg is like a very small, like little farming town like type thing,
very tiny.
Yeah, not very many buildings, and they all talk about going to the big city and stuff. But I really like the track. It's a beautiful track, and I could see this being still a very grand emotional way to start the game. You know, for the Sega CD version, if you've never played it before, you'd be like, wow, like what am I in for? Like, this is really big and robust. And I think even starting the game out like that, even if it didn't match Berg perfectly, it could really set the tone that this is going to be a massive adventure.
Right. And, you know, doing this comparison, we're not going to just have this show littered with comparisons, because that would just be the whole show.
Yeah.
You know, but I think since we're on the, you know, we just did this comparison, why don't we go ahead and listen to just a few seconds of the Saturn version, and then we'll also listen to the PlayStation Portable version. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So here's the Sega Saturn version of Berg. Thank you.
very much like the PlayStation one.
Yeah, it's...
Well, it makes sense. It's like the PlayStation is kind of like an update of the Saturn version.
It's very much the same, yeah. The same track. And the PlayStation, like you said, it was a port of the Saturn version. Right. So the music didn't really change too much. There's some differences we'll talk about a little later on, but let's go ahead and listen to the PlayStation portable version, the PSP version, real quick. Can see that's a really more rich version, mm-hmm. And that's the PSP was playing stream audio, so there was a lot more that you could do with it that didn't have so many limitations,
right? You could really see those violins really stand out, and you could hear all the little bending and
all
stuff,
the vibrato
going on.
Yeah. And yeah, it was very, very pretty. And doing this comparison kind of brings up a good point. Lunar Legend was released for the Game Boy Advance in 2002, which is kind of like this retelling of Lunar the Silver Star story, but it ditched some of the main plot points. It's, to be 100% honest with you guys, it's just not a good game. Yeah. I don't think there's anybody who would disagree with that statement.
Yeah, especially compared to the originals. And that's one of the reasons why we're not talking about this version today, even though it is essentially another remake of the original game.
Right, and there's also this... which kind of speaks for itself.
It kind of sounds like I'm listening to my neighbor play it through the wall too loud.
Oh, God, that's so awful. Poor GBA. Oh, anyways. But yeah, I think that the PlayStation Saturn versions are very similar. The PlayStation Portable obviously has a lot more that it can do. Mm-hmm. And the Sega CD actually had less limitations as well because it's Redbook audio. So
right.
There's a really cool kind of comparison between all the different versions of this kind of simple, lazy track that has a lot of different expression, I think. But you can see his idea and his focus.
Yeah. And like we said, we're not going to probably do too many more comparisons since you kind of get the idea, but there's so many songs of this soundtrack that it might be fun to go out there and look them up and dig in, compare it yourself.
Yeah, and you can let us know what versions you guys like of certain tracks.
Oh, yeah.
Something we don't play today and we play like the PlayStation version or something, and you guys are like, dude, this Sega CD was the better one. Let us know. I mean, that's awesome. We'd love to include those down the road.
Right.
Do need to mention here, though, that the Sega CD soundtrack was done mostly by Iwadare while he was at Cube, but also a few other Cube members worked on this as well. There was Isao Mizoguchi, Hiroshi Fujioka, and Yoshiaki Kubotera.
Yeah, and today we're only playing the tracks composed by Iwadare-san, but we wanted to mention these people because they did contribute to the audio as well.
Right. Anyways, so let's talk about this game a little bit.
All right, so the plot of Lunar the Silver Star was written by a novelist, Kei Shigema, and he wanted to do something a little bit different in a genre that they felt was filled with games that had stories but had no storytelling, which I thought was a really interesting way to put
things.
Way
to put that, yeah.
So the game takes place in a fantasy world called Lunar. It's a relatively small world that's orbiting a massive barren blue planet called the Blue Star. And as you play the game, you find out that the Blue Star was once inhabited by people, but was later rendered unlivable due to years of war. Then the powerful goddess Althena moved everyone to the Silver Star, or Lunar, and put four dragons in charge, keeping the elements of the new world safe. So if you sought out to use the dragon's power to help and protect everyone, you got the title of Dragon Master. And in the beginning of the game, you learned of Dine, one of the most powerful and famous Dragon Masters, who's actually from Berg. He met his fate while defending the goddess Althena.
Yeah, and while both the Sega CD and the PlayStation version are somewhat similar, there is a debate over which one is the authentic version.
Right.
So Kei Shigema, scene writer at Studio Alex that you had just mentioned, made a really good analogy in an interview that he did for the making of Lunar Seeing that was bundled along with the packaging. He said that they do both reflect the world of Lunar, but he believes the story of Lunar actually exists. However, the person telling the story may change. And this is, I think this is so clever how he said this. He says, Mr. Sega CD tended to forget small parts and didn't explain the details of things, but he was the original storyteller. Mr. PlayStation, on the other hand, who's a bit smarter, has better memory and more capacity for expression, told the history of the Lunar world. Sega CD maybe forgot some of the characters and told the endings in more of a finalistic term, while the new storyteller told us a lot more. I think that's just an incredible way to put it. And it's true. I think that, you know, the Sega CD, I mean, this is a system generation gap, right?
Mm-hmm.
The Sega CD is so much more basic in terms of what it can do versus the PlayStation. It's, you know, next generation kind of successor.
Right.
And so it only makes sense that every time you're moving to a new platform where you have less limitations, you want to kind of bring more to the table and give more of an explanation, more detail. So that made sense.
Yeah, and we see a lot of that with games that are being remade now. Like, look at how many times Resident Evil 1 has been remade, and each time it gets more and more detailed. But
right. Metal Gear, for example.
Yeah, and I really love the analogy of using the systems to not only explain how the story was told, but it also really tells you how the system worked as well, mm-hmm. that like the PlayStation had more memory and a capacity for expression, I thought was really clever way to put this.
Yeah, it's interesting too, because you kind of look at it like somebody telling you Bible stories or something, you know, like the Sega CD was just one kind of medium for expressing this game and the PlayStation was another version.
So, right.
I think both are valid and both are very fun games.
Oh yeah, and one of the ways that this was made more rich and stuff like that was by adding new characters to the remake, and the existing ones were given a much deeper backstory and right. just different expressions and stuff like that. Really the biggest difference in the Sega CD versus PlayStation is the heroine Luna. So for example, in the Sega CD version, when Alex leaves on the boat to Maribia, Luna stays behind. But the creators thought that this would leave the player not really connected to her character, so it was a major revision in the remake to have her come along. Yeah. And I actually got to that part in the story, and there was so much tension and excitement as to what was going on. And when she gets on the boat, I was like on the edge of my seat. I was like literally very, very excited. And I wasn't even told that was like a pinnacle point of the story, but yeah. I was just, once it was over, I just felt like, wow, that was so amazing.
Yeah. I think I was watching your stream and you're like, wait, no, she's leaving. She's
yeah.
leaving?
I was like, no, don't.
Yeah.
Like, you have to come.
Yeah. And the character starts speaking. It's really cool little cutscene. And it's a very emotional thing too.
Yeah, and it's all done in sprite artwork. It's not animated, you know, cutscene or anything like that. It's just really still has a huge emotional weight on it, just as sprite work.
Right. Another interesting thing is the characters in the Silver Star story are a bit older. You know, they're not given like certain ages or anything like that, but they have definitely more of a matured look and behavior in the remakes. And the team at Studio Alex brought up a good point. They said, you know, since people that originally played the game on the Sega CD when it was released, they had grown older, you know, so it made sense to bring the age of the characters up as well, so that as a player, you could form a more relatable connection.
Yeah, it's just much more believable if you have any aspect of love in the story, that a little bit of an older person would be more believable, and children kind of are taken as like, well, you don't really know what love is and things
right,
like that.
Right.
So it just makes more sense that a lot more people would just get a little bit more invested in the story.
Right. And maybe in your late teens, you start developing connections, like real friendships and connections that
right.
last a lifetime. And, you know, so this, I think, does kind of play into that as well. Anyways, let's get into our next track. This is called Fun Traveling, because it's always fun to travel.
Sure is.
And this is for the Sony PlayStation, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
Thank you.
You just heard Fun Traveling, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare for the PlayStation version of Lunar, the Silver Star Story.
This is a really cool track. This is the map theme.
Yeah.
This is when you're on the main world map and you're kind of moving around. It's just a happy-go-lucky track.
Yeah, when I first left Berg and got to this overworld theme, I was like, oh my God, this is so much fun. And it felt so bright and happy and cheerful. I mean, you've been wanting to go on an adventure and now you're on one. And I was just like, I felt like I was like really happy. And I could imagine this track being played in like a montage of like people traveling to places they've never been and like pointing at things like, oh my God, that's so exciting. Look at that. And like, let me take a picture next to this sign and collecting knickknacks and, you know, bumper stickers and stuff like that. But it was just so fun. It was just really exciting.
You know, this music actually turned into safety music for me, because when you start going into these really dark caves and forests and go through all these really like ominous areas, you know, and things get really just really rough and in your face, as soon as you leave that area, this music starts back up again.
Yeah,
so it's kind of that safety music as well.
All right, so let's get into how this story unfolds a little bit. In Lunar, you play as a young man, or possibly a teen, named Alex, who's grown up with the tales of the legendary warrior Dragon Master Dain and dreams of becoming the next Dragon Master. The game opens up with Alex standing at Dragon Master Dain's cliffside grave with his lifelong flying cat companion named Nall. His buddy Ramus appears suddenly and convinces him to go on a quest to obtain a dragon diamond from the White Dragon Cave. Luna, Alex's love interest, tags along to make sure he doesn't get into any trouble.
This is a kind of a funny part, because when you go tell Luna that you're going to go on this quest, this little mini adventure with Ramus and Nall, she actually kind of gets pissed.
Yeah.
She's like, why weren't you, were you thinking of not including me and not letting me go? Like, you're going to get yourself hurt and all this stuff. And then she's like, well, if you're going to go, then I'm going to be there with you.
So yeah.
You're not going without me.
Yeah. And it's not quite sure who Luna exactly is at this point either. Right. Like, I wasn't quite sure if she was like his sister or like a, you know, a possible love interest or a friend. But, and after the team makes it into the depths of the cave, they find Quark, an aged wise dragon who sees hidden potential in Alex and asks him to travel the world and become its protector as the new Dragon Master. So returning to Berg, the group decide to stick with Alex as he ventures out.
Yeah, they all have their motives too, you know? So like, Ramus sees some financial gain. He's kind of, he's like this funny, like fat, pudgy dude, you know, who's kind of like thinking about like business and all sorts of, you know, profit and everything, right? Anyways, he decides to sell the dragon gem at this huge city called Meribia, and that's kind of his reason for wanting to go.
And he also has like a little bit of a side reason to almost prove his dad wrong. Like, it seems like his dad doesn't think that Ramus will amount to much.
Yeah, and let's clarify here. Ramus' dad is actually the mayor of Berg.
Yeah.
So he kind of has some proving to do, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyways, Nall, his reason for wanting to join is because he's Alex's lifelong friend, companion, but he also is kind of shrouded in mystery. He wants to find out who he really is, or what he really is even.
Right.
And then there's Luna, who just doesn't want Alex to go out and kill himself.
Yeah.
And that's her reason. So they all kind of have this kind of hodgepodge band of friends going out and onto this, you know, major journey. I think it's really cool.
Yeah, and it's great to see that they all have their own motivations. They're not just like, sure, I'll tag along. Like, you know, there's, you know, money and proving someone wrong and finding out what you are and then protecting the people you love. I mean, that's just right off the bat, that's a very dynamic group of people that are all interested in something different.
Right.
Yeah, so to continue on their new journey, they first have to set across the frontier to the port town of Saith. But first, they have to travel through the weird woods, which is blanketed by a very thick fog. But out of nowhere, Luna starts singing and magically clears the path with her song. And she has no idea how she did this or how she knew it could work.
You could see that was coming. You know, there's something about her, you know.
Right.
Like Luna, the game's Lunar, you know, there's something going on there. Nevertheless, it's still like interesting to see how these characters kind of grow and unfold as the story progresses.
Right.
You know? Anyways, so she clears out this fog in the weird woods, which is an awesome name for
yeah.
woods. And the group is all of a sudden surrounded by this horde of monsters. This traveling warrior appears out of nowhere. His name is Lake, and he wipes everybody out. He's super powerful, and it's like you want him to stay in your party like, the whole time.
You get to control him, which is great. And you see his health is massive and he deals so much damage. And I think he does like every move does three turns, just for picking one attack.
He's basically unstoppable.
Yeah.
Anyways, even though he laughs hysterically at you, he does wish you the best of luck and you continue on out of the forest.
Yeah, he does become pretty supportive, which was nice to see.
Yeah.
But anyways, as you finally get to Saith, you meet Nash, a magician in training from a prestigious magical school who needs transport back to his home and joins your group on the boat to Maribia. This is where the plot opens up like a floodgate, which is currently where I'm at. So I need to get a little bit further, which will be exciting.
Yeah, we want to tell you more about the game. We really do, but...
Yeah, we're going to end up keeping it pretty light on the story and plot points because Studio Alex really created a super rich story, and we feel like spoiling it would be a huge disservice to them and anyone interested in playing the game.
Yeah, but what we do want to say is that the game has a truly beautiful love story, maybe one of the best ever written for the platform.
Oh, yeah.
All right, so let's get into our next track. We were talking about the town of Saith, which is a town by the sea. This next track is called Town by the Sea, and it's from the Sega CD version of Lunar, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
You just heard Town by the Sea from the Sega CD version of Lunar, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
I really like this one.
Yeah.
It's very smooth. It's got kind of a like a port town vibe, too.
Yeah,
it's
kind of islandy, Caribbean, like we like lots of seafood and water type stuff.
No, it's just a really cool track. And I think, you know, all the town music in this game is just super chill.
There's like really cool like wood blocks and it's really laid back and very pronounced and I really liked it a lot.
Yeah, it's a really good one.
Yeah, so on paper, Lunar the Silver Star sounds like most RPGs. It's a top-down game featuring 2D sprites in a 2D world where you navigate the characters through towns and forests and caves, etc. But it's so much more than that because it really comes to life with character and charm and detail and just the vision of the game.
Yeah, this is... You know, it's really not anything groundbreaking as far as the gameplay goes. You know, you have your characters, the lineup behind you, you move them around, mm-hmm. and you get into battles. And there's nothing really that hasn't been done on other platforms that came before it.
Right.
Really, if you look at it, this is simply kind of just a reskin, like a more beautiful version of the Sega CD and what we mm-hmm. saw there.
Well, even the idea of it's a, you know, like a medieval-ish swords and arrows town where there's no technology and magic and dragons. That's extremely cliche for RPGs, but I just felt like so much detail and love was put into it. Even when you're walking around the towns and when you go into a building, every layout of the building is completely different. So they may look like the same from the outside, but when you go in, they're all oriented differently, like everyone's house is on a street. Like they mm-hmm. would be set up differently. There's different layouts. Some are wider, some are longer, and all the buildings are like that. And I just thought right from the start that was a detail that they didn't want it to feel like you're going to the same building every single time.
Right. Also, the terrain is very different.
Yeah.
It's not just like these cookie cutter, you know, checkerboard levels that you're moving around. There's some real environmental thought, I think, put into it, like where trees or things are placed and all that stuff. Even though it is a, you know, a typical RPG in a sense, as far as the gameplay goes, I think you're right. As far as the story telling and the kind of emotional impact that it has, it's really so much more. And you have to kind of look over some of the cliche RPG elements.
Yeah, and even when you talk to NPCs, it's fun. They say funny things, or they say things that are very helpful, and but it's done, the translation is done in such a great way that it's it's really entertaining to actually go up and talk to people.
We talked about this during our Popful Mail episode, and how Working Designs really took a lot of pop culture references, even things that you think wouldn't be really appropriate, sometimes they would throw in there. And I think like in the first town, there's like some kids like, oh, you know, I'm eating my Wheaties, I'm going to be strong, you know, and just stuff like that, like things that were funny to us at the time. They made these little references here and there. And I think that that adds just so much more to a simpler game.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The character development is the main thing, the main focus of this game. And a few of the characters here, there's Alex, who's the lead, who you play as. He is a teenager from a small town, big dreams. You got Gnoll, that cat like flying thing that we talked about, mm-hmm. who's been with Alex since birth. There's Luna, who starts kind of, I guess, as a childhood friend, and then evolves into this, you know, you were saying love interest, but also a lot more. There's a lot more going on there.
Because you can see that in the beginning, Alex doesn't think of her as like this pretty girl that, you know, he just sees her as like someone I know and some friends, and everyone else is like, oh my God, Luna's so gorgeous. And like, I've heard of this singing woman, and it's like, but she's just his friend. They grew up together.
They're just the girl next door.
Yeah. He's always late because he doesn't really care that much.
Exactly. And then Ramus, who's Alex's friend, grows into this interesting character. And he has, like we were saying, he has his own motives and stuff. Then there's Nash, who we brought up, who is this, he's an interesting character. He's kind of obnoxious. He's kind of like a wannabe magician, but he's also pretty badass.
Oh, yeah. I was very happy when he joined my group, but he was definitely very obnoxious.
Yeah. There's a lot of other cool characters that you play as. Kyle is one of the characters that I love. He is this muscle-bound, like, yoked-out warrior dude, almost like a kind of like a Native American kind of feel to him. And I think when you first meet him, he is like plastered drunk. He's like hammered drunk. And he's like, I may have had too much to drink last night, but all the ladies didn't complain. And it's just, he's a misogynist. He's just probably a very horrible person when you first meet him. But as his character unfolds, you learn a lot more about that. He's actually this really soft guy inside. And it's really interesting.
It's that machismo, man.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyways, let's get into our next track. This is from the Sega Saturn version of Lunar, the Silver Star Story. And this is called Have a Big Dream, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
All right, that was Have a Big Dream, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare for the Sega Saturn version of Lunar.
You know, this track is it's funny because this is like it's a very uplifting track.
Extremely uplifting.
Yeah, and when you hear this, there's always a point where it's like something bad happens in the story, and then Gnoll comes in with his big face on the screen, and this music starts playing. It's like, hey, it's all good. Let's keep going. And it's like this total like emotional reverse.
Right.
And I like that. And so this track had to be in the episode.
Yeah. Well, good. And Knowledge is a great character that he has like this ability to always flip it. If you're like wanting to, you know, get out of a battle, he's like, no, we can beat you up. Let's go. And then it's like, if you're like, hey, I don't feel like doing this. And you know, he's just always encouraging or kind of is the antagonist for a lot of different things, which is, which is great. But this song definitely is very peppy and uplifting. And it's almost like the song is telling you, you can do it. Like whatever you want to do, like you can do it and we'll be right here with you. So it's really nice and encouraging And like you said, this could be played after a very deep, dark point in the game, and it really revitalizes you. It's like taking a potion, I guess.
Yeah. So this version actually isn't a version that I'm familiar with, mm-hmm. because I didn't play the Sega Saturn version until much later on.
Right.
Because I purchased it at a secondhand shop in Japan, and I had played through the PlayStation version, so I saw this, and it was like $5, and I was like, of course,
yeah,
I'm gonna buy it. So I hadn't heard this version, but the Sega Saturn is, first of all, it's one of my favorite systems, yeah. of all time. It's incredible. The games that had the 2D stuff it has is just incredible.
Yeah. Well, and you got me a Sega Saturn for, it wasn't my, maybe it was my last birthday.
Yeah, it was really.
So
birthday.
I have a Japanese Sega Saturn that I'm looking forward to modding and spending a lot of time on.
I'm staring at it right now.
Yeah.
It's like, play me.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the Saturn is quite powerful in the sound department. It's interesting. So in the Saturn itself, there is a custom processor. It's called the YMF-292, also known as the Saturn Custom Sound Processor. It's got 32 sound generators, which can act as either FM synth channels or PCM channels. So we can play back FM, sequenced or streamed audio. And it has all these built-in effects. There's like reverb, pitch shift, symphonic filters, all sorts of stuff. And like I said, it's actually really, really good sound hardware, but it's limited by the amount of RAM that was available to it. So you only have 512 kilobytes. So you can't really do a lot with these enormous samples, mm-hmm. but because it can do FM synth, you really can do whatever you want.
Right.
And so I think that is incredible. And that's why there's a lot of really good Saturn music out there. Now, the other thing is there's the other drawback to this Sega Saturn sound hardware is that it has no hardware sample compression. So again, you had to use these massive samples that would take up all the memory you had
right.
in RAM. So it kind of made it difficult to create something as lush, maybe as a different platform.
Yeah. Well, even Achilles had his weakness.
Yeah. And compare that to the PlayStation version that we were talking about, right? So the PlayStation sound processing unit, or the SPU, was a 16-bit Sony processor, and it supported ADPCM sources with up to 24 channels. It had a sampling rate, same as the Saturn's, 44 kilohertz. It could do PCM audio, and it could also support MIDI sequencing. It also had some built-in sound effects, just like the Saturn. It had pitch modulation, envelope generation, looping, digital reverb, all sorts of stuff. And on the PlayStation, as well as the Saturn, you could also do CDDA, which is just Redbook audio.
Right.
So doing a little comparison between, I know we said we didn't want to do too many comparisons, but listening to this track on the Saturn and just a little bit of the PlayStation side by side will give you an idea of how they were kind of looked at differently, I think.
Yeah.
So this is that Sega Saturn version again. And this is the PlayStation version. Now, the PlayStation version really is a lot more robust, but
yeah.
that doesn't mean that the Saturn, you know, it doesn't mean the Saturn is like a lesser version. It was just composed differently, I think.
Right.
And I think Iwadari-san maybe had some other things in mind when he was creating the PlayStation port.
Right.
Able to do maybe something a little different.
Yeah. More time in between making it. There could also be new influences and different ideas, things that he wanted to try. Plus, you know, sometimes it is nice when you get a port of something and it's not exactly the same thing. So if you've already right. played one version, you might still want to play the other one.
Yeah, that's why I think it was good to put that version in, because I hadn't really heard it, and it still has the same feeling. Still
yeah.
has the same
Still a great notion. Version.
Yeah. Anyway, so Lunar was remade again for the PSP in 2009-2010, titled Lunar the Silver Star Harmony, again developed by Game Arts and published by Game Arts in Europe, but published by Gung Ho Works in Japan and Xseed here in the States. We're going to play a track from the PSP. This is called Traffic, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
You just heard Traffic, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare for the PlayStation Portable version of Lunar.
Now, this is an awesome version.
Oh, it's so beautiful.
It's really good.
It's crazy to think that, I mean, this is the handheld. This is a PlayStation Portable that is producing this sound. It's really crazy.
I mean, you know, it's what, 10 years later, right? 11 years later. And so it's using streaming audio. Mm-hmm. So a lot of these instruments, I'm sure, are live recorded instruments. And there's just no comparison. Like it's almost unfair because you couldn't get the same, you know, you can't make a MIDI instrument sound like a real violin. It just doesn't happen, but you get pretty close. And so mm-hmm. I think that it doesn't mean that the PlayStation, Sega Saturn version or the Sega CD, anything like that is outdated and not enjoyable to listen to.
Right.
It's still very valid and still serves a great point. And I remember those versions. So for me, they hit home.
Right. And I mean, it's music is one of those things that's well loved no matter what. I mean, every system that we've ever come across has music that's worth loving that people will always listen to. I mean, if only live instruments were the absolute only thing that people love, then of course, like Nintendo, Game Boy, all that stuff, nobody would ever listen to that music ever again. And right. people would just be making live versions of them. But just like these games, they last forever and you can always go back and listen to the MIDI versions and you know, the very low chiptune stuff that's just so fun to listen to.
Yeah. So you haven't played the PSP version, right?
No, I haven't.
The game looks beautiful.
I'm sure it does.
Yeah. It's music's fantastic and probably... You know, it's probably a lot closer to what Iwadare-san had in mind for the soundtrack when he originally wrote it for, you know, the Saturn and the PlayStation. But there's a downside. You know, the game is super easy. It's incredibly easy. And Lunar is a very hard... The PlayStation version is extremely hard.
Yeah, that was one thing I noticed when I first started playing it is that you had to save often because you're going to die a lot.
I don't know if they made it for new gamers who just... are not good at game. I don't know what the reasoning is, but there's almost no challenge. So if you're in it for just the story and you know, which actually might not be a bad thing if you just want to experience,
you can play it on the go so you can get through a longer game when you're on the bus or at work on lunch or something like that. So I could see that being, you know, a great way to play the game, you know, 20 years later and you know want to experience it.
However, there is some other things that make the game actually kind of passable, and that's the load times. Atrocious.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, it's so bad. Like everything that you do has this insane load time behind it. The PlayStation didn't have, the Saturn didn't have that. And most certainly the Sega CD didn't have that. And so, you know, things like music cuts out during the loading. It's just so distracting that even for me, I was like, I was so frustrated. I was like, oh God, loading again.
Yeah.
God. But you know, that being said, the game is gorgeous. If they could fix that loading time. Ooh.
It's funny that, it seems like different generations of gamers have different opinions of loading times. Like we grew up in cartridges that didn't have loading really at all. And, you know, now modern gamers, like I was playing a PlayStation 3 game and the loading time was so insanely bad. I was like, how did this game ever get liked? And this was like a game of the year type game.
Right.
And then when they brought it to the PlayStation 4, boom, loading times were gone. But I was like, how is this game even playable? Like, I hated it.
Well, and I think we're more impatient now, right? Like, a lot more impatient. Internet speed is so much better.
True. You know?
Because think back to, like, C64 days, right? When you had, like, 5-minute load just to play, like, a very simple game. Right?
Yeah.
So maybe it's always there, but we've just changed to where we just can't accept it anymore.
Well, and those things that cause the loading times are not the things that I'm most interested in the game, so...
Yeah, so let's listen to another track from the PSP. This is called Mysterious Cave, and it's an incredible track. We'll be right back.
All right, you just heard Mysterious Cave, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare for the PSP version of Lunar.
What an incredible track.
Yeah, that was insane. I mean, there was so much rich sound and cool instruments, and whatever that string instrument was, it reminded me of like some type of Middle Eastern guitar. I don't know what they're called.
Right, like, but I think that's a sitar. Right?
Okay, yeah, I was thinking sitar, but I was like, I mean, I'm thinking like the horse. Is that like the horse? But but I was like thinking how if someone tried approximating that, like in chiptune and MIDI and all that stuff, I was like, oh my God, that would sound so horrible. It just sounds like somebody just zapped some static in there. But it sounds so beautiful. And so it adds right. so much character and kind of puts you in this mindset of like a different world, you know, outside of what we're used to.
Now, if I didn't know this track, if I didn't absolutely already adore this track, I would have totally pegged this as a Falcom JDK track. Mm-hmm. It sounds like it's straight out of an Ease game.
I almost wrote Ease, that I was like, this reminds me, because it just played through memories of Salsetta and how it's so vibrant and so many different instruments and punchy. I was like, that totally reminded me. And I was like, nah, I'm not going to write that.
Yeah, Brian will say it. Yeah. No, it's an excellent track. Let's get into, let's go back over to the PlayStation and play a track called Go, Go, Go. And we'll be right back.
You just heard Go, 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 composed by Noriyuki Iwadare for the PlayStation version of Lunar.
Now, this is kind of, it's interesting because in the episode, we've kind of started with the slower tracks, the town music, and kind of build up in the last track. And this one is a lot more frantic, a lot mm-hmm. more fast paced. I mean, the title alone, Go, 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 with
yeah.
an exclamation yeah. point at the end. It feels like the great escape, but like to a prosperous, you know, ending, you know,
it's yeah.
very, it's a lot of energy and it's still very uplifting.
Yeah. It reminds me of the first time I played Final Fantasy VII and you're trying to escape when the bomb's about to go off. And there's like, there's this sound that makes you feel like you need to move, you need to get going. And this track is very urgent and those heavy drums, it has those increasing scales and then it kicks up with some galloping and that little kick drum that feels kind of like a heartbeat. It just makes you feel like you need to get moving, but it's not like
forced. It's not forced.
Yeah. And it's not like oppressing you. It's like pushing you, like get moving. Like it's not like, oh, you're going to die, you're going to lose. It's like, no, come on, keep going. You got to go. And so it's not quite ominous. It's still kind of uplifting in a way, which I really liked.
Yeah. So behind every good RPG, there's this solid battle system, and Lunar totally delivers on this front. This is true for all iterations of the game. So building up from that last track, let's listen to some of the battle music. We're going to start off with the PlayStation version. This is called Fighting Spirits.
We'll be right back. You just heard Fighting Spirits from the PlayStation version of Lunar, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
This gets my blood moving so fast. Like, oh, I'm hot right now. Like, I just feel like, ooh, just so energized. Really just incredible. One of my favorite battle tracks of all time. So much energy.
Yeah, no, battle music is always really good. And well, it is good in a game that is good. If right. Battle music is not great, it really can drag down a game, because you're going to be listening to it all the time. And for me, this track felt very much like Wild Arms or Final Fantasy, in the sense that it's fun to listen to over and over. You're going to get into a lot of battles when you're grinding out in an RPG. So having a song that's fun to listen to, that's the right amount of energy and danger, because you don't want it to feel too lazy, and you don't want it to feel too overly intense.
Frantic.
So then you save that for the bigger bosses. And this, I thought, was a perfect job, and it had variety and it had little aspects to it that were nice touches to where it wasn't just, you know, a quick loop of something.
Let me kind of go with you on that, because I think you're right. You know, it has, it's not too frantic, it's not too lazy. It has this explosive intro, but then there's a calm, you know, during the track, and it's still moving, still like right. this energized beat, but has like a little bit more of a slower pace to it.
Mm-hmm.
And it goes through its iterations as you play, as you battle.
Yeah.
I think that's really important for a battle track.
Well, in this game, it was always exciting when you first got into a battle, your heart's kind of racing, and then you're like, okay, I can handle this. Especially once you get going and you realize that, okay, this is going to be tough, but now I'm getting my bearings and I'm leveling up enough to where, like, I probably won't die this time, but I still have to be careful.
All right, so let's talk about the battle system a little bit.
Yeah, so in this game, the battle system is turn-based and carried out on a type of battlefield, kind of like an invisible chessboard. And what I mean by this is you set up your characters in a formation beforehand, and during the action, it's really useful as to how far away you are from characters and how close they are to enemies and things like that.
Right.
So if you're too far away, you will have to burn a turn to get closer to them, and that might put you in danger.
Right.
So you have to be a little bit careful. So it has this element of strategy to it that's actually really nice.
Yeah, this adds something that a lot of other RPG battle systems lack: positional strategy. It almost reminds me of Fire Emblem a little bit.
Right.
Sometimes a battle can be won or lost just by who goes first and where they're positioned out in the field.
Yeah, and instead of a bar that indicates who's going first, characters and enemies move based on their speed rating, not the order that the moves are selected. And what I mean by this is Alex is always the one that goes first. You pick what he's going to do, and then like Luna and stuff like that, and you go all the way down, and then when you get Nash, he's always last. But Nash has such a high speed rating that he usually goes first before enemies and Alex.
Yeah, so when the action actually starts, he's like right there. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's really neat. That adds a whole nother level of strategy to things where if you have a slower character, you might have to be careful, because say like Luna will use a bow and arrow and she can knock enemies backwards. So that might push someone out of the reach of another character. And then you already selected your move and now you're in danger.
Yeah, I really enjoy the strategy aspect of the battle system. And I always thought the battles were so much fun.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't really get bored of them either.
Yeah, but I also want to bring up another difference. Unlike RPGs like Final Fantasy and even the original version of Lunar, the PlayStation version of Lunar doesn't have random encounters.
Right, right.
You can see your enemies walking around in the environment, and you can choose to avoid them or battle them to gain XP. So
yes.
I was doing this a lot where I would come across a new enemy type, and I was like, I don't know if I'm really ready for this one yet because it's so different. And since the game starts out so difficult, I was, you know, worried that I was going to die. So you might end up sticking to enemies that you're used to.
I forgot that the Sega CD didn't have those on the screen.
Mm-hmm.
So like I was playing that version again, because that's the version I maybe have the least or the most vague memory of. And so I played that in preparation for this episode. And I was like, oh my God, that's right. There's random battles, random encounters. And it made it really difficult to make any progress, because every 3 steps, I feel like I'm getting in a battle, but it still adds something enjoyable. It's, you know, there's something to the random encounters. Some people hate them.
Right.
I adjust whatever, you know, whatever the game offers, I guess. So
well,
it doesn't bother me too much.
And one thing that was great about the PlayStation version is not only were they on the screen, but they actually gave them a function. So you could actually use them to do different things. You could manipulate the enemies on screen. Like there was this one, I think it's called like the great baboon or white baboon or something like that.
Right.
It like makes this crazy scream, and then it comes directly at you, and you can trick it into running into blocks, which sometimes you actually need them to break the blocks to progress. But you can also get these really difficult chests that are hidden behind blocks, and you can trick them into breaking the blocks for you. And it was fun getting used to that, and it felt cool being able to manipulate enemies. So it was a really nice feeling.
Yeah. Like a lot of other RPGs, 2D turn-based battle system, it's really easy to learn, really fun. It takes some time, you know, like when you start off, if you're getting frustrated, if you're dying all the time in the beginning of the game, stick with it, because it becomes and develops into this really rich and enjoyable battle system experience.
Oh, yeah. And I was telling you before when I was first playing this that the game starts off really hard. And I mean, it's not like insanely hard, but it's definitely like I need to save pretty much before every battle. And
what was the first tip I gave you before you started playing?
Save a lot, save often. And you can save whenever you want, which is great. When I first started playing, I was like, this is really difficult, and it's hard, and you're not quite sure how the menus work. And so you're kind of limited to the attacks that you kind of know. And then eventually it starts to get a little bit easier. And I thought, wow, this is like a really great way to make you feel like the characters. Like you're off on your first adventure. You aren't used to doing this. You're not really like a warrior. So at first it's really hard, and you know, you may die a lot, but as you get more experience, you as the gamer and the character, you start to develop more skills and more confidence in battle, which I thought was just a great way to connect you to Alex and his team.
Yeah. And they don't give you a tutorial on how to do this stuff. It's kind of like you learn as the character learns.
Yeah, and you just got to try out the spells, and you may not know what they are, so you just got to try it and do it.
Yep. So anyways, we heard the PlayStation battle music. I really love the battle music from the Sega CD, so let's go ahead and take a listen to that, and we'll be right back.
You just heard the Sega CD version of the battle music composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
Oh, man, that was good.
That was really good.
Oh, that's so good.
And I noticed it was kind of the reverse of the PlayStation music, because the PlayStation music starts off
very
more intense and then kind of mellows out, whereas this one starts out very much more mellow and really ramps it up and gets nuts. I thought it was really cool.
You know, I don't know which one I like more.
I was just thinking that. I hope I don't have to pick.
Yeah, I don't know. Which one do you like?
Oh, man.
It's like choosing your children or something.
Yeah.
No, but this version, I feel like it was a lot more upbeat and maintains that intensity as it goes. Whereas, you know, we were talking about the PlayStation version, it has more, I guess, dynamics where it will slow down, it'll speed up, it'll slow down, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And this version really just keeps going a 1,000 miles an hour. I really love the galloping low end that you know, once that jumps in, that's when you know the blood is really flowing.
Yeah,
but no, this is incredible, and you get to hear this over and over. So
I think from I guess the way that my brain works, if I were to try to come up with a track that was for, you know, battling over and over and over, I like how this version starts off a little bit slower, because right in the, as soon as you get into a battle, the first thing you have to do is pick your attack. So you're
good
in your menu, and it's not as frantic, and you're like, okay, cool, let me pick my attacks. And you know, sometimes by the time you pick your attack, now it's like kicked up, and it that could feel very dynamic, that it's like, okay, now let's roll.
That's a very good point. I think you're right. Like when you get into a battle, the first thing you're presented with is your menu, right? And so having maybe a little bit of slower intro for the track makes more sense. But still, the PlayStation version is amazing. You know,
yeah,
we can't dismiss that, but. I think that I think the Sega CD version wins.
Well, and the PlayStation version too has a neat dynamic that it brings with the music is that it makes every beginning of a battle feel frantic, and you're like, oh no, I'm getting into a battle,
right.
And then it's like, you know what, you got this. You have experience.
You got this.
Yeah,
bro.
You're gonna get through the menu, and then you're gonna take these guys out and move on. So I like that both versions have a totally different thing that it does to the player's mind and emotions, which is cool.
Right. So we listened to the music on the Sega CD version and then also the PlayStation version, which is completely different. But there was also some differences in the battle system, right? So there's more spells in the original. There mm-hmm. was, I'm not sure, I think it was like 15, 16. But in the Silver Story Complete, you know, the PlayStation version, there was only 8 mm-hmm. that you could get for your character. So it was a lot more limiting. But I think that was probably for the best. Maybe yeah. a little bit better balance.
Or maybe they found people abusing spells or saying, I never used this one once because it was not worth it.
So yeah,
like, well, why even put it in the game then?
Exactly. Also, there was an auto battle feature. So mm-hmm. in the PlayStation version, you could select AI and the battle would just kind of go for you. Now, this isn't always a good thing. Now,
if of course.
If you're just, you know, trucking through the woods and all these enemies around you are really easy, AI is your best friend because it can just, you know, have it auto attack everything.
Yeah.
But for enemies that pose even the slightest challenge, you really have to use your brain, and AI isn't going to handle it for you.
Which is nice because you can turn this off and on in the middle of the battle. So you can say, okay, at the beginning of this battle, I want to do it myself. And then, all right, I killed an enemy that's really dangerous. So let me just turn it on auto. And there's been some games that I've played, some RPGs, where I'm like, okay, the auto battle is fine. Like mm-hmm. I played through Persona 4 Golden and was like, you know what? You guys can do your thing. I'll do mine. And and then also in Bravely Default, I really liked how they set that up. Was really neat.
Yeah.
So it is kind of a useful thing, especially, you know, some people don't want to grind forever, but you need to. So let me just do it and let the characters take care of it. And but you have to worry about the, you know, them burning through all your potions because you can't carry that much and you have to restock a lot. So interesting.
There's some, you know, checks and balances for mm-hmm. using the AI. Anyway, so we're on this kind of action-oriented kick. Let's move over to the PlayStation Portable and listen to a track called Fighters, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
You just heard Fighters from the PSP version of Lunar, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
He loves those violins, man.
Oh, yeah, especially in the PSP, man. Ooh. I guess if you can't use them elsewhere, this is the time to use them.
Nah, this is a cool track. It's got, a lot of action. I like the dynamics. I think it, you know, it builds, it drops down. There's, I don't know where this plays in the game.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know how to relate it to gameplay at all, but absolutely loved it, and so I was like, hey, do you mind if we put this in?
Yeah,
of course you're not gonna say no, so
right.
Yeah, it's a cool track.
No, I like this one. this one brought an interesting picture to my mind as far as the song is really beautiful, but it's really forceful and kind of pushing you forward. And that percussion is really kind of heavy and really feels like it's driving that like urgent feel. Uh-huh. And then the violins and trumpets and stuff get to be real beautiful and like flourishy and stuff like that. And it reminded me of like that scene in the Titanic where like the percussion is the boat. And then like Leonardo DiCaprio and Kate Winslet are like the people in the front of the boat that get to be all cool. And so that's what the violins and stuff are. So there's like that urgent push forward. And then the violins get to be the fun, flourishy, like exciting part.
How do you come up with that?
I don't know. I just was like thinking like, man, this thing is like heavy. And but it's still beautiful at the same time. And then just, I don't know, just popped in my head.
All right. Well, that's a new one. At least it wasn't Terminator.
Yeah. At least it wasn't Terminator. Yeah.
What do we got next?
Next up, we have a track called Four Heroes, and this is also from the PSP version.
That was the Four Heroes from the PSP version of Lunar.
This is a very, very different feeling track, but I really liked it. It had this kind of like hint of danger, and it felt like two people in a duel. They're like eyeing each other and like circling around each other, waiting for someone to make a move. And then there's that part in the track where it just kind of explodes, and it feels like maybe that was like the first attack type thing, which was, I thought it was really cool. It had like this like deadly dance feel to it.
That's exactly what I was going to bring up. It felt like a waltz.
Yeah.
Almost like you're waltzing with your, with the enemy.
Right. Right.
You know?
Yeah.
And you're kind of looking at each other and, you know, there's this, you know, dancing around and there's like this really, you know, intense kind of undertone that's being kind of hinted at and nobody's saying anything. And mm-hmm. then like when you finally like, you know, grab hands, like that's when it like explodes and things start moving around.
Yeah.
It's a little bit more intense. The four heroes signify the four heroes of Lunar in the game.
Right.
And so it has this kind of regal feel and it tells a story. I think it has this kind of like if you're listening to like an old story, an old legend, it kind of has that feel to me as mm-hmm. it's kind of expressed through, you know, musical notation.
Well, I mean, I haven't completed the game, but I would assume that, you know, Alex and his group will become, you know, a legendary group of people like Dragon Master Dine, and as they progress, and you could see them as they turn into, you know, amazing people that have done great stuff for, you know, their world, which I think is really cool. And hearing this PSP music, it makes me really want to play the PSP version, but I mean, you said those load times. I wonder if there's a Vita version of it.
Well, you can play it on the Vita.
Okay, and I wonder if that would cut down some of the load times a little bit.
I played it on the PSP, so I don't know. If any of you guys have played it on the Vita, let us know, but I still think you should stick with the PlayStation version. I think that's the...
Oh, no, I want to, but just seeing the different look that they gave to the game and how each version of the game has something different it brings to the table, and this music is just insane.
It is incredible. So not only the music in the game, the voice acting was just incredible and very well done. Mm-hmm. And they got a really interesting cast of characters to do the voices of these characters.
Yeah. I mean, if you watch the behind the scenes thing, you can see how much effort and time was put into, you know, recording the voices of these characters, which was not something that was super common. I mean, it wasn't unheard of, but to this level was insane. So for this game, it featured voice acting in both Japanese and the American version. The original versions of the game contained about 15 minutes of voice acting from the main characters. Right. And even though there were a ton of characters in the game, there was only 5 actors per version. So there were 5 Japanese actors that were doing all the voice acting, and then there was 5 American ones right. that were doing all the American acting. And so the American actor for Alex, I thought was really interesting. I wasn't going to go through the names of all the people that did right. the voice acting, but Alex is voiced by Ashley Parker, who also did voices in Potful Mail of Slick
right.
and Fiero in Magic Knight Rayearth. So he mm-hmm. was no...
stranger. He was working with Working Designs a
yeah.
lot.
Yeah, and Slick was a great character, but that's not his only claim to fame, which I thought was really funny. He was actually in the first season of Making the Band when they made O-Town. I don't know if anyone remembers that. I think that was in, what, the late 2000s? Or
early
2000s, I mean.
Could not tell you.
But yeah, I remember hearing about this band, O-Town, and then when I read that, I was like, what? That is so nuts. So he became like a pop star.
Like a boy band?
Yeah, like a boy band pop star, and which I thought was really nuts. And there's also some other really cool things about the voice acting. So the remake for the PlayStation, the Japanese cast was completely replaced. So there was no returning voice actors from the original. But in the North American version, the entire 5 voice actors were brought back, plus another 15 were added to it. Because like we said before, they expanded on the characters. So now secondary characters got voice acting time and stuff like that, which
right,
was
right.
really cool. And one of the interesting aspects about this was that we said earlier that the characters aged in the PlayStation remake, that weren't the same age as before. So when Ashley Parker came in to read for Alex, at first they were thinking of replacing him because he did the original voice. Mm-hmm. And they said he might have grown too much. He might be too old to play this part. And then when they decided that, you know, the characters have aged, maybe a little bit more of an adult voice would work, and it actually worked out really great.
Yeah. No, I think, and his he doesn't sound like this old man. Or
no,
anything.
Yeah.
He still sounds like a boy.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I think that it was a wise choice, and it fit with the animation and the characters and stuff already, and so I think it worked. I gotta say, though, one of the best voice actors in this game is John Truitt. He's the voice of Galleon.
Oh,
who
yeah.
is, I'm not gonna say any spoilers here, but his voice is so nasally and like
it's
whiny,
so bad guy good.
Yeah, it's so good. And,
he talks a lot in the, well, I don't know about a lot, but he talks a good amount in the behind the scenes, you know, video, making a video. Right. And just that's his voice. And that's how he talks. And he just talks about how it was so fun to be like this bad guy. And it was just like, oh man, that's so cool to hear.
Yeah, he's like, you have to enunciate every word. And I was just like, that's so, what a baller.
Yeah.
Anyways, but up until this point, we've heard, you know, lively town music, inspirational music, some action-oriented battle music, but there's a very delicate side to the soundtrack as well, with some remarkable and emotional tracks. So let's start on the PlayStation with a track called Recollection.
Just heard Recollection from the PlayStation version of Lunar, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
This is a tearjerker, man.
Yeah.
Ooh.
I mean, this rivals some of the most sad and beautiful music that you could hear in an RPG, like, you know, something related to like Final Fantasy VII, or even like we loved some of the Wild Arms tracks, just to name a couple PlayStation RPGs that have you know, gorgeous music.
Yeah, Final Fantasy, Xenogears. Oh man, I mean, there's some really good stuff out there, mm-hmm. and this is got to be in the top. I mean, for like kind of tear, like mourningful kind of mm-hmm. Feeling, and it's heavy, but it's very light, and it, right. you know, I can't tell what that instrument is. It's like it's almost between like a piano and a guitar.
Yeah,
it's,
a little bit.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to tell. It's kind of hard to pinpoint, but it sounds really pretty. It
yeah,
sounds really
that,
clean.
And that single note that's by itself, like right towards the end before the loop, was just so quiet. Everything was quiet around it, and it was just by itself. And you're just like, wow, that was really powerful. And then it picks back up into that kind of sad melody. And just that little touch alone, I think, ramped up the intensity and in the beautiful nature of that track even more.
Yeah, when you get that reverb thrown on there, then it's like...
Yeah, I don't know what it is about, you know, slow pace, you know, the kind of like twinkly piano yeah. sounds with reverb is just,
oh,
it's too much. But yeah. Anyway, to move on to the next track, we have another great one, and it's called Sad Events. So get ready for that one.
You just heard Sad Events from Lunar the Silver Star on the Sega CD.
Wow. I mean, this is a game that so far for me has been, you know, very happy and fun and tongue-in-cheek. And that the idea that there are parts like this, that music required like this is yeah. necessary is, I don't know. I'm really excited to get to those parts because that was so... sorrowful. I mean, I'm not playing the Sega CD version, but the idea that there are sorrowful, sad parts in this game is like I haven't gotten there yet, so I don't know if I'm even ready for it.
It goes through a lot of different ups and downs, and mm-hmm. that's what makes any game great. There's got to be some kind of highs of and some lows, and so this was just an excellent track. I've listened to this numerous times, and every time I hear it, I got to listen all the way through. I can't skip over it. It's just so good. Mm-hmm. And clearly piano. This is Red Book audio. So, you know, you get that true piano sound. Nothing, you know, emulated or, you know, no MIDI, anything like that. This is just a clean piano. Iwadare-san's probably just sitting at the keyboard, just doing his thing.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, awesome. Then he goes home and has a glass of whiskey. I don't know. It's just a great track. Anyway, so Lunar, the Silver Star, had about 35 pieces of music. The Silver Star story had over 100 written for it.
That's insane.
Yeah. I think there's like 60 or so in the game, but a lot more was actually done. And with all this music and the mass fandom kind of followed around it, of course, soundtracks were released. So the original game soundtrack was released in April of 1992 by Toshiba EMI and contained 15 tracks, including some arrangements. The remake soundtrack was included in box with the game, like mm-hmm. I was talking about earlier, and contained 24 tracks. And the interesting thing here about this is that it had several arrangements from the Sega CD version mixed in.
That's cool.
Yeah, yeah. So when I listened to the CD, and I listened to it a ton, because back then we didn't have a lot of game music albums in the right. States here, you know? So I listened to this all the time. And so much, in fact, that I actually forgot which tracks went with which game.
Right.
Like, I would just hear them. And, you know, I was listening to battle music and I was like, man, is this the PlayStation version of the Sega CD? I totally forgot because I had heard the soundtrack way more times than I had played the game, right? So it just kind of came naturally.
That's such a cool thing because, you know, I'm sure they had banked on a lot of people that were playing the remake, had played the original or at least heard about it. And for people that were playing the remake for the first time and had never played the original might go back and say, wow, like the music for this was really cool. Let me check out the older version and see if I like it or not. So, I mean, and if not, it's just like, this is where it came from. This is all connected and it's such a cool thing for collectors.
Oh, yeah. So let's get into our next track. This is called Thieves Bazaar. It's from the Sony PlayStation version of Lunar, the Silver Star Story Complete.
Okay, to brighten the show back up, you just heard Thieves Bazaar from the PlayStation version of Lunar.
I like this one, dude.
Yeah.
That xylophone, the muted trumpet, it's cool.
When I've seen a lot of tracks that are called, like, you know, have to do with thieves or, you know, stuff like that, they tend to be kind of fun. Like, I don't know what it is about RPGs where, you know, it's like thieves is like a bad word, but, you know, they like to have fun.
It has a kind of thievery, right?
Yeah.
They always turn out kind of fun.
Yeah, they tend to be interesting characters with an interesting lifestyle, and they can be very useful in these games. But, I mean, this track was fun. It was energetic. It had really interesting instruments and a neat pacing and stuff like that, which was really nice. I like this track quite a bit.
Yeah. So, okay, we've talked about the differences between the games a little bit. The graphics we kind of touched on, but maybe kind of elaborate on some of the differences between the PlayStation and the Sega CD version, kind of what the transition was, you know, across, you know, what, 8 years of, you know, difference and a whole system generation gap.
Yeah. I mean, we talked about how different systems have very different limitations, and none of them are bad. The, you know, Sega CD version, the Saturn version, the PlayStation, they all are very beautiful games. They just get a little bit more detailed. More colors get added in. I think one of the biggest things for the PlayStation was the cutscenes are now all fully animated, and they're, I mean, insanely gorgeous, and the moving parts and they're dynamic. That adds a lot to the game, but I think that the Sega CD still had really amazing cutscenes, great graphics. It was just much more detailed, I think, is all that really happened. The battle sprites got bigger. So they're not so much squatty little like squished people.
Yeah.
You know, like, the little SD forms.
Yeah.
They're still, you know, very SD.
They're still kind of squatty. But
but there's more detail and they're bigger and the enemies have, you know, a more brighter feel. I think a lot of the colors have a brighter feel to everything.
Yeah. Even like the world map. I mean, everything was like a tile set, right?
Mm-hmm.
In both versions. But the PlayStation, the remakes, kind of took it a step further, added a little bit more natural, like flowing rivers and trees.
It feels
and
more organic. It's less blocky. It's harder to pick up the patterns than in the earlier versions.
Right. The biggest change for me, the most noticeable, I mean, aside from the cutscenes, was like the towns. The towns are so more fledged out in the remakes.
There's so much variety to them too. They're so beautiful and colorful, and they can get more of that town's aesthetic feel, where it feels more like a seaside town, or it feels more like a forest dwelling type place,
or a bustling city.
Yeah, you know,
like I got to just past Maribia in the Sega CD version, and you compare that with the PlayStation version, there's almost no comparison. It's like night and day difference.
Mm-hmm.
The PlayStation is bright and moving, and you know, it just feels like this really busy city, where the Sega CD version is a little more bleak, a little more, I wouldn't say desolate, but I'd say not as vibrant.
Yeah, it lacks a little bit of the character, because when you're looking at some of these towns, I mean, there's so much life that feels like in the PlayStation version. And even though the earlier versions are still beautiful towns with lots of detail, they do feel a little bit more sparse and empty, I guess.
Yeah. So with the animated cutscenes, that was the biggest difference.
That was huge.
Yeah. It's almost, I think it was like 46 minutes, over 45 minutes worth of animation.
Yeah.
And it's incredible artwork. And it complements the game in such a way that it adds new life for people that have played the original. And it also has this really enjoyable experience for those who, you know, were getting into it, like myself, you know, had already started playing other games that maybe were a little more technologically advanced, mm-hmm. but giving this really cool, you know, anime cutscene to kind of fledge out some of the character development.
Right. Yeah. And a lot of times what you'll see in these RPGs with the cutscenes is the characters in the game feel, you know, very, very simple and maybe a little bit lifeless and not as much character to them. But then the cutscenes bring that character to life, and you get to see them move around and talk and their mannerisms and stuff. And this just took it to a different level, because it wasn't doing like what some of the other RPGs that are, you know, have 3D and have 3D cutscenes, and they had those limitations of the 3D animation, where this one had, you know, traditional hand-drawn animation, which, you know, people have loved for years and years, and was very refined and was very beautiful. So it really added a lot to those 2D sprites when you got to see them move around and talk, and how, like, Alex was very quiet and kind of like passive about things, and Luna was very expressive and very nurturing, and and you got to really see that.
Now, the one thing about the cutscenes, I think, that, and you got to this part, was the boat scene.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very pivotal point of the game, and I think probably one of the most emotionally intense parts early on,
mm-hmm.
in the, you know, that first kind of introduction area. Right away you can see the amount of detail that went into it. In the making of disc, they talk about how they used the hand-drawn animations in conjunction with 3D technology to actually, you know, rotate that, you know, the camera angle around the boat, which was really interesting. I mean, nowadays it's, you know, it's like cake. You could do it in like half the applications you can get for like a dollar on the app store.
Right.
But back then you could see how much time and effort it took to really make, you know, just a 3-minute cutscene come to life and give you a lot of emotional value.
Well, and if you've seen a lot of Japanese animation, you know that it's very dynamic, but it tends to be very simple as far as the number of animated cells that they use, where like they'll reuse a lot of things, and they'll have dynamic poses, but they'll be simplified, or like someone will be jumping, it'll be the same pose, but like their shirt will be flapping or something like that. So in these cutscenes, it felt like 3D animated, you know, panning cameras and rotating stuff like that. And for that scene alone, just added so much emotional value to it.
Yeah, I was watching you during the stream, and you were just like, staring.
Yeah, I couldn't move. Yeah. It was just amazing. I didn't want to miss a second of it.
It's funny because Dusty, who I was talking about earlier, we played this game together, he actually went back, and this is only like shortly after we beat the game, and he started replaying it. Mm-hmm. And he actually hooked his PlayStation up through a cassette recorder.
Mm-hmm. Like a VHS.
Like a VHS recorder. And for every cutscene, he would save the game beforehand, mm-hmm. and he would hit the record button. And so he made videotapes of the recordings. Yeah. I don't know if he ever got all the way to the end, because it's a lot.
Yeah.
You know, but I remember he was like dead set on getting the whole thing, like basically making a movie out of the cutscenes.
Right. So I wonder if he still has those VHSs anywhere. Maybe at his mom's house.
Yeah. We'd have to knock on his door and ask.
Yeah.
But while we're on the graphics, I do want to bring up one last kind of thing. Like, it's kind of like a little Easter egg that's thrown in. It's not really needed for the game, mm-hmm. but it's the bromides. So in the Silver Star story, the remake, it contained all these little extras within the game. And one of those extras was these like playing cards almost that you collect, and they'd be in like these random positions or like random locations in the game. The first one I'm going to give you a little spoiler here is in Alex's house. If you go downstairs after you get the crystal from the dragon's cave, you can get the Luna bromide.
Oh.
And you can open it up in the menu, and it just shows her kind of like standing there, like in like little pose. And it's really interesting because you can get all of the characters or various characters in the game. And in the case of the Silver Star story, it was all female characters. So, yeah, so it was just like these animated or these single drawn, you know, basically like artwork, making of artwork for the game. And there were 10 bromides in all in the first Japanese Saturn version. And there were 13 for the other releases, including the US version. So those bromides were so fun. You go around and collect. And I believe I was just talking to Dusty the other day because I was telling him about us doing this. And he's like, oh, yeah, the PSP version, the collector's edition of that, you actually could get physical bromides that came with it.
Oh, wow. So there were cards, actual physical cards that you could play with. That's cool.
Yeah. So anyways, those little kind of bonus about the game that was kind of joked about. I was talking to my wife. I was like, are bromides, like, were they a big thing in like Japan? Did kids like collect? And she's like, oh, yeah, I had like a ton. I was like, of what? And she's like, you know, like, you know, pop bands and singers. And
That's funny.
They're like baseball cards for us or something. You know, they would collect like pop stars and stuff. I don't know.
Wow. That's weird. Cool. I mean, that's very, very cool.
It's funny. Anyways, let's get to our next track. This is called Solitary Wolf, and it's from the PSP version of Lunar.
You just heard Solitary Wolf, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare for the PSP version of Lunar.
It's a really nice track.
Mm-hmm.
Lovely. I love that that guitar, that live guitar. You can hear the steel strings and the slide across them. That's always awesome.
Oh, yeah. No, and I like how punchy everything is. It's very abrupt. Everything kind of stops. There's not really a lot of trailing notes, which is kind of neat. It adds a little bit of energy to the song.
Yeah, I have no idea where this plays in the game.
No, yeah, neither do I.
Absolutely none. Solitary Wolf. I mean, maybe I could think maybe Lake. No, I don't think it plays during his theme. But anyways, no, excellent track. That groove, just that persistent groove, just keeps everything feeling like it's moving along. And even though it has like this really lazy like melody on top, it's still just, I don't know, just feels good. Just feels warm and and bouncy and refreshing.
Yeah, it feels like if you are the solitary wolf, everything seems to kind of work out in your favor. It's got that kind of fun energy to it.
Yeah. All right, so we've been waiting the whole episode to bring our guest on and talk to him for a little bit. Super excited.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, so Iwadare-san, thank you so much for joining us today and welcome.
Hi. Hello. I'm Iwadare, Noriyuki Iwadare.
Awesome. So let's go ahead and jump right into it. Could you tell us about your path that led you into a career in the game industry? So he said, well, I always enjoyed music composition, was actively doing it, but I never expected it to become a profession.
で、 友達に誘われて、ゲームの音楽を作るようになりました。
あ、そうなんですか。
うん、そういうゲームの音楽の会社に入る、ゲームの音楽を作る会社に入ったんです。うん。
And then one day I was invited by a friend to join a company specializing in game audio, a company that made game audio, I should say. So I ended up starting there.
そう、それまでずっとキーボードを弾いて、まあ、バンドで仕事をしてたんだけども、だんだんね、テクニックもあんまりうまくないんで、ピアノも上手じゃないんで、じゃあ作曲をしてみようかなという感じでね。
Until then, I was playing keyboard for quite a while in a band, but realized I wasn't very good and had pretty bad technique. So I thought, you know, maybe I should give composition a shot.
うん。してみたら、うん、いいんじゃないかと言われて、それでゲームの音楽を作る専門の会社、当時は、そういう会社がなかったんですよ。
あ、そうなんですか。
で、そういう専門家が作る会社に入って、そこから本当に曲を何曲も作るようになりました。
Yeah, so I tried that out and was told I was, you know, decent. But at that time, there wasn't really a company around that was specifically composing game audio. But later on, I ended up joining the company and wrote several songs there.
あとは、そうですね。その会社に入って、Afterburner 2を作って、その後に、Darius 2って知ってる？
So he said, after I joined, I ported the music from Afterburner 2 to the Sega Genesis and also did work on Darius 2. Have you heard of that?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Darius 2, of course.
うん。それの、コンバートをして。で、あとメガドライブでは最初に作ったのは、やっぱりインベーダー90ってやつで。
ああ、そうか。
うん。その次が、ジノーグ。ラングリーザー。
はいはいはい、ラングリーザー。
うん、そんな感じ。そうやって、だいたいメガドライブを中心に曲を作ってったのかな。
Yeah, so I converted those, but the first game I did on the Genesis must have been Space Invaders 90. After that, I worked on Wings of War, Langrisser, and stuff like that as well.
Yeah, I'm really glad that you mentioned those because, you know, we tend to forget anything you've done before Lunar.
Right,
It's
right.
It's just so different.
So different.
So how would you define your musical style?
作曲に関してはほとんどノージャンルでいきたいと常に思っています、はい、どんな曲でも作れるようになりたいと思ってます。
I don't think I'd put a specific label on my composition style. I want to be able to create any and all styles of music, so it's easier for me to just say that I don't have a specific genre that I'm tied to.
で、もちろんね、小さい頃から、まあ、大体中学生ぐらいの頃から曲を聴いてるんだけれども、クラシックのモーツァルトやベートーベンなど。
Of course, when I was young, I listened to a lot of classical music, particularly in junior high, like Mozart and Beethoven.
また、ビートルズとかね、ビリー・ジョエルとか、僕、ストレンジャーが大好きで、ビリー・ジョエルの。うん、
But also stuff like the Beatles and Billy Joel. I really love Billy Joel's song Stranger.
よく聞いたんだけども、そういうポップミュージックとか、ディープアップルとかレインボーとか、レッド・ゼッペリンとかのハードロックとか、そういうのも大好きで、で、彼らの音楽をやっぱ勉強したんで、そういう音楽をいっぱい作りたいと、
はい、
彼らに負けないような曲を作りたいと思っております。はい。
Yeah, so I listen to pop music and stuff like that. Also a lot of hard rock, such as Deep Purple, Rainbow, Led Zeppelin, and so on. And I studied these artists quite a lot in the hopes that I could do something similar that would, you know, at least try to be at that level.
Yeah, no, we've actually seen a lot of other composers mention stuff like that, but I mean, that's a wide array of inspirations, which is very cool.
Right, like Deep Purple and stuff. We saw that.
Led Zeppelin's come up a few times as well.
Right. Okay, so our next question is, what are your musical influences? Something that's inspired you or someone?
僕がね、そうだな、最初に自分のお金で映画を見に行った時が、実は宇宙戦艦ヤマトっていうアニメの映画なんですよ。アニメーションムービー。
はい。
宇宙戦艦ヤマトって知ってる？知ってる？知らないよね。知ってる？
So he says the very first movie I paid to go see was an anime called Space Battleship Yamato. And then he asked us, have you guys heard of this before?
Yeah, I'm not that familiar with it.
Yeah, I've heard of it, but only just watched some clips recently because, you know, for the first time yesterday, actually, because I knew he was going to mention it.
ちょっと勉強した。ありがとう。それのね、作曲をしたのが宮川明さん。
はい。
あ、じゃあ宮川康さんっていう人で。はい。彼はもう日本のそのポップ、日本のポップミュージックのもう先端を行ってた人なんだけど、もう亡くなっちゃったけどね。
はい。
で、彼の曲とか大好きで、やっぱりそれからとっても影響を受けました。
So it was composed by Yasushi Miyagawa, and in Japan, he was really at the center of pop music. He passed away a while back, but I loved his music, and it had a major influence on me.
あとはね、多分1980年から90年代の、あの、マイケル・ジャクソンとか、プリンス、マドンナのあたりの、アメリカンポップミュージック。
はい。
もう大好きなんです。
うん、僕も大好きだった。I loved a lot of American pop music in the 80s and 90s too, like Michael Jackson, Prince, and Madonna.
Oh yeah, we loved them too, and unfortunately Madonna's the only one left.
And we're 80s kids, man. That's yeah. That's our jam.
そう。だから、やっぱりあのクラシック音楽とかは大好きだったんで、ベートーベンとかチャイコフスキー、マーラー、あとラヴェル、もっとたくさんいるけれども、そういう人たちが好きですね。
And again, a lot of classical music as well. Beethoven, Tchaikovsky, Mahler, and Ravel. I mean, there were a lot, but yeah, those composers I especially loved.
Yeah, and we can definitely see that inspiration in some of your work, especially right. The PSP version.
Yeah, I agree.
So today we're talking about Lunar on the Sega CD and PlayStation. So not specifically the composition, but what does this game mean to you? I mean, it might be a little bit of a difficult question to answer, but...
はい。Lunar.ルナは、僕のことを本当に世界中の人に知ってもらえたと思う、最初の作品ですね。
He said Lunar was the first game that put my name out there for the world and people actually noticed.
Yeah, I would say so.
多分、maybe ね。メガ CD のそのルナ、ザ・シルバースターっていうのから、曲を作り出したんだけれども、まず、それはオープニングとか、村の曲とか、バトルの曲とか、
はい、
エンディングの曲とか、多分全部の中の半分ぐらいは作ってるはずです。主要な曲、主な曲を担当してます。
It all started out on the Sega CD with Lunar the Silver Star. I was responsible for most of the music, including the opening, the town music, battle theme, etc. Out of all the tracks in the game, I did probably about half, mostly the main songs.
うん。で、本格的なね、RPG の、ロールプレインゲームの作曲っていうのは、本当にこれが初めてだったんだけれども、
はい、
これを認められて、大勢の人にちょっと認められて、それからルナ・エターナルブルー、その後にグランディアなど作っていく感じですね。
It was my first attempt at composing music for a fully fledged RPG, but since it was so well received, they had me do nearly all of the music in Eternal Blue, and then other games like Groundia and stuff as well.
Yeah, you'd never be able to tell that this was your first experience with making RPG music. I mean, you hit all the different kinds of music, and you did it really amazingly.
Yeah. So the music in Lunar, it's very important because it emphasizes the story. What was your approach to using your music to enrich the storytelling aspect?
ね。僕は曲を作るときは、その主人公、主人公とか登場人物の気持ちになって作るんですよ。
はい、
でその人がその場所に、例えば村に、例えば戦闘の場所にいた、
はい、
敵がこう目の前にいた、
はい、
その時にどんな気持ちになってそこで立つんだろう。
So he said, when writing music, I really tried to understand the feeling of becoming the hero. For instance, exploring a village, being in combat on the battlefield. What was it like experiencing it through their perspective?
あの敵を倒さないと、彼女を救えないとか、その時のこの怖いような、でも頑張らなきゃいけないような気持ち、
はい、
それを、心情って言うんだけど、心の声っていうの、まあ、それを代弁する形で作ってます。
If I don't defeat this enemy, I'm not going to be able to protect Luna. That feeling of fear, but knowing you have to push through, it's kind of hard for me to express in words, but it's kind of like the feeling that comes from the voice of your heart. And that's how I went about writing the music.
戦闘とかね、楽しい冒険をしてるとき、楽しいときってどんな、自分がそこにいたらどんな音楽が流れてくるだろう、どんなことを感じるだろう。
はい、
でね、悲しいとき、別れのときとかも、 自分がその場所にいたらどんな気持ちになってで気持ちどういう気持ちになればか分かれば僕たち音楽家はそれに対して曲を作ることができるから、はい、まずその気持ちになるってことをすごく意識して作りました。うんはい、これはね本当に今でも変わらない作り方です。
うん、
はい。
So he says, if you were these characters and you entered the battle scene, what kind of music would flow through you? What kind of music would you hear inside if you're having fun on an adventure? What music speaks for those feelings of lost or parting?If I was the one there, how would I be feeling right now? It's those feelings that help me create the music. And this is the way I continue to write music today.
It's no wonder with an attitude like that why your music is some of the best RPG music ever. I mean, this is, it touches so many different people because of all that thought process.
Yeah, and there's, you know, there's something, if you really look at it from like an emotional perspective, music is like a very emotional thing, right? And mm-hmm. being able to put yourself in the character's shoes and really try to understand what they're going through,I think that emotional quality you need to be able to create something that speaks to the player, right?
Right.
You need to be able to connect with them at some level.
So the original game came out on the Sega CD, released in 1992. So can you tell us about your experiences creating the music for that version of the game?
このゲーム、メガ CD だから CD の中にゲームが入ってました。
はい。
で、1枚のゲーム、一枚の CD なんだけど、うん、その CD の中には、プログラムとか、グラフィックとか、うんまあ、いろんなものを入れなきゃいけないんだけども、音楽で使えるのが実は30分しか使えなくて。
Alright, so he says, this was for the Sega CD and just a single disc, so everything had to fit on it, the program, graphics, etc. So for the music, we only had, you know, about 30 minutes to use.
で30分の中で、あの時は50曲、まあ、60曲以上かな作んなきゃいけなかったんで1曲30秒しか使えなかったんです、
はい、
で1曲30秒でどうしたらいいんだと今、うん、例えば今のゲームとかは1曲大体3分間のループで作ってる、
そうですね、
2分とか3分のループでね、はい、で30秒のループで作ると本当に何も語れないのよ
はい。He said originally there were like 50 to 60 songs which meant that each song had to be about 30 seconds or so. What am I supposed to do with 30 seconds for a song? In games today, for example, one track is usually about 3 minutes, maybe 2 minutes for a loop. But seriously, for 30 seconds, how do I get anything across?
で、それが、で、ループ、またね、ループするとき CDDA だから、今はね、ADX とか使ってるんで、
はいはい、
ストリームっていうのを使ってるから、ループがすごく綺麗になるんだけど、
はい、
その CDDA でやると、一旦曲が流れましたって言って、針がこう戻る感じ。ちょっと時間が空いてからこうまた音楽になりますよね。
And this is CDDA, right? Now we're using streaming like ADX that can have these beautiful loop points, but because it's CDDA, it takes time to go back and start playing the track again. So it breaks when the music loops. そうですね。そうですね。
そう。この時間が何秒かかるんだっていうのを常に計算っていうかまあしてでそこになっても曲が大丈夫なように。ループしても違和感を感じない、
はい、
そんなに違和感を感じないようにとにかく曲を作ったんです、
はいはい
うん、これが大変でした
So using trial and error, I listened to them over and over to make sure they at least sounded as natural as possible. That was quite the challenge.
Oh, it definitely sounds extremely challenging.
Yeah, well, I mean, these loop points, you can hear. I mean, the song ends. We've played a few Sega CD tracks. The song ends, and it clearly ends.
Mm-hmm.
But how do you end and then start it back up again without sounding totally broken?It's got to be a challenge.
Right.
So that leads me into our next question. How is the music for the Silver Star composed? What kind of hardware did you use?
はい。USA でもあったのかな ?NEC っていうメーカーの PC9801 っていうコンピューターを使って、で、レコンポーザーっていうソフトがあったんだけども、それで作曲をしてました。日本のね、カモミュージックっていうメーカーがあってそこから出てるレコンポーザーっていうソフトなんだけど、はい、多分日本の作曲家はこのソフトを相当使ってたと思います、はい、日本では本当スタンダードなシンケーターソフトですね
Now I'm not sure if it came out in the US or not but everything was pretty much done on the NEC PC9801 and I used software called Recomposer which was made by a company called Common Music which was pretty standard sequencing software used in Japan at that time.
で、音源は、その外ハードウェア音源なんで、ローランドの S33、 330-U220-D110 っていう、サンプラーとかシンセサイザー、
はい、
あとコルグの M3R、ヤマハの DX7 とか、あとサンプラーの赤いの S900。
For the sound sources though, there were quite a few we pulled from. So the Roland S330, U220 and the D110, and then some samplers and synthesizers. The Korg M3R, the Yamaha DX7 and the Akai S900.
1000まであったかな。とにかくそういう感じの、いわゆるこう重たいハードウェア音源、ソフトウェア音源じゃなくてハードウェアな音源を使ってましたね。
Maybe it was the Akai S1000. Well, regardless, everything was from a hardware sound source, not software based.
Do you still happen to use hardware anymore?
今もね、持ってはいる。
はい。
そう。あまり使うことはないんだけど、でも、たまに使います。やっぱこれじゃなきゃ出ない音があるんで。
He says, I have them. I just don't really use them anymore. Yeah. However, sometimes there's a certain sound I need where I'll have to like pull them out and use them again.
That's awesome.
Yeah. I wish that I had that set up in my house. I would keep it out and use it every day.
We're very different types of people, though.
Yeah, but let's get into our first track with Iwadare-san. This is from the Sega CD version of Lunar, and it's titled Hero in Town.
The track you just heard was titled Hero in Town, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare for the Sega CD version of Lunar.
I would love to see this track fully orchestrated.
Oh, yeah.
I would love to just go, you know, sit in the stands and just watch this massive orchestra just pull this off. You can hear everything. It's so detailed and so defined, mm-hmm. very articulate.
Yeah, when I was listening to it, I was thinking, what limitations? Like, this sounds so beautiful. it's very heavy. And even though it's heavy, it's still very adventurous and uplifting in a kind of regal sense.
Right. Well, I think that's because you get the drum, the marching snare mm-hmm. on top. So it adds that extra kind of regalness to it. But those trumpets and the horn sections, they kind of fall off. There's this one like arpeggio section where they're just like, dun, 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 mm-hmm. dun. And it sounds clever. It's in the background, but it, I guess, boosts the track up even more and adds, you know, all these little details, I think, make it really enjoyable.
Right. So, Iwadare-san, can you give us a little bit of your thoughts about this track?
Yeah, 懐かしいね、この曲はね。
He said, man, that brings back memories.
そう、もう全然覚えてなかったから、でも僕の曲です、本当に。
I totally didn't remember this at all, but yeah, I wrote this. Yeah, good.
そう、だから、途中で転調するところとかが頑張ってるなと。で、ね、30秒とか言ってたけど、この曲1分20秒、もう1分20秒あるね。
I think the player is still partway through their journey at this point. Now, I said earlier that the tracks are supposed to be about 30 seconds or so, but this one's like a minute 20 or something.
Yeah.
長いね。
That's quite long, huh?
多分怒られたね。
I think they got mad at me for that one.
うん、うん。
All right, so a few years later, Game Arts released the remakes for Saturn and PlayStation. And these games didn't use Redbook audio, but instead used sequenced music. Obviously, you know, space limitations. But because of this, how did you feel about composing the music for the remakes?
はい。こう、まあ、 もちろんゲーム発売したのは、ゲームアーツなんだけれども、別の会社がこれを作ってました。まあそれはよくある話なんだけども、だから彼らの会社ではそのプログラミングと SE を作ってたんですよ。で、サウンドエフェクトだけはすごくしたいんだみたいな感じで、すごくね、音楽がね、ちょっとね、ないがしろにされたというか、ちょっと寂しい感じになってしまって。
Of course, you know, Game Arts produced the game, but another company did the development. That's common knowledge. But they were really hard set on creating real sound effects, which needed a lot of space. So they said to me, you know, we really want to do these sound effects, so this is all you're going to get for music. And so the music turned out to be kind of a bummer.
Oh, man.
またね、そのゲームになってからも音のバランス、音楽と SE、サウンドエフェクトのバランス、これが、サウンドエフェクトがでか大きすぎると、音楽が聞こえなくなってしまうんでしょ。
But anyways, I went ahead with their request and did the best I could, but it was kind of disappointing. Then, as it turned out, the sound effects were way too loud, the balance was awful, and always ended up overpowering the music.
でね、ルナはそういうゲームじゃないよっていうのをずっと言ってたんだけども、なかなか受け入れられなくて、うん、イーブンな、50-50 な音量で攻めていこうよと言ったんだけども、それを聞いてもらえなくて、サウンドエフェクトがやたらと大きいバンバンバンバンって言って音楽が消えてしまうゲームになってしまって、とても残念だったです。
Music was particularly important for Lunar, and it was never meant to have the sound effects drown it out, and I told him this. I said,At least keep it 50-50, but unfortunately it turned into a game that had all these obnoxious like bam 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 sound effects and was quite disappointing for me.
そう。でね、その後に日本では PSP から PSP で、ルナハーモニーオブシルバースターっていうのが、発売されました。で、これが僕の中では納得ができる、聞いてもらいたいシルバースターだと思っております。
Anyways, after doing the music for Silver Star Harmony, I felt like I was really able to express the music the way I really wanted. So I'd like it if you would all listen to it.
Wow, that's, you know, really interesting to hear the back and forth battle with trying to get the music made for the PlayStation version of this game.
Right. I didn't realize he wasn't very happy with it. And so, you know, I still love it. I grew up with it. And this is what I know. So
right.
I didn't see his side to it that...There was a lot that he wanted to do that couldn't actually, you know, get done.
Yeah, I mean, we thought when we listened to the Silver Star Harmony version that this might have been more your vision. So on that note, let's play a track from the PSP version. And this track is called Moribia.
Alright, you just heard Moribia for the PSP version of Lunar the Silver Star Harmony.
What a fun and uplifting and fresh track. I mean, for me, as someone that came from a small town that eventually moved to a bigger city, like this is something I can imagine it feeling like because everything seems so new and big and exciting and colorful that when these characters got to Moribia, it was like nothing they'd ever seen before.
Right. You know, going back to the first track that we played, Berg, everything was kind of sleepy. It was a little lazy, kind of laid back. And this has, you know, a lot more energy and excitement. It's more bouncy. It feels like you're in this bustling town, this busy city, and I really enjoy this version of the song because I'm familiar with Maribi on the PlayStation, and so hearing it like this is, I mean, this version is incredible.
Right.
It sounds so clean. That flute, that lead melody just shines. It just sounds so clean and defined. It sounds a lot better than the PlayStation version, actually.
Right.
So, Iwadare-san, could you tell us your thoughts about this track?
Hi. Luna の、遊んで、初めての街に行った時の曲かなだと思うんだけれども、なるべくこう村とね差別化をしようということで、村ではドラムとか入ってないんだけども、街ではやっぱりドラムとか、ドラムスとかベースとか入って、元気よく、元気な感じの曲にしましたね。
When you're playing Lunar, this is the first city you visit. The village...Well, to explain the distinction, the village music doesn't really have drums, but the city has these instruments to create a more lively feel.
で、ギターとか、トロンボーン、トランペットとかは僕が自分で演奏してますね。
Also about this track, the guitar, trombone, trumpet, and some other real instruments were all played by me.
That's amazing.
That's awesome. I didn't realize. I mean, I was thinking like maybe piano or something like that, but like guitar, trombone, trumpet, That's a lot. I mean, what a talented dude.
Oh, yeah. And it's also a great way to explain the distinction between the town music and the city music. I actually didn't pick up on that it was missing the whole like drum percussion section from the little sleepy town. So that actually works out really great. So we know that you used a bunch of live instruments for this recording, but what other hardware and software did you use to write this music? Like, what was the process in that?
はい。この作品の頃には、CDDA じゃなくて、ストリーム、ADX っていうのを使ってやったんで、で今まで作った曲っていうのを全部ブラッシュアップしてでリアルレコーディングをいっぱいやろうということで、作りました。ただしね予算が全然なかったんでだからもう僕ができることを何でもしようと。
The Silver Star Harmony is not CDDA, it's all ADX, or streamed audio. So I brushed up all the songs and aimed for a real studio recording. Unfortunately, I had almost no budget, so I figured I would just do everything that I could myself.
まず、最初にね、オカリナを買って。
すごい、すごい。
オカリナを自分で買って、で、自分で、
That's awesome. So he says, I first bought an ocarina, and what you hear in the game is actually me blowing into the thing and playing.
Wow, that's definitely a first on this show.
Oh, man, that's so cool.
Yeah, that's so cool.
Wow, that's awesome.
ギターを弾いたりとかね。いろいろやって。録音しました。
So then he says, I also played parts for the guitar and a bunch more. So we're going to hear some trombone next.
Yeah, definitely spoiling us.
トロンボーン、ちょっと待って。用意をしてない。
He said, oh, I didn't get that ready. Hang on a sec.
トロンボーン出した方がいい?
He said, do you think I should get it? 大丈夫です。 大丈夫です。 ありがとう。
で、まあそういうもう録音して完成度高いものを目指したと。
So he says, I wanted to be as close to a real sound as possible, so that's why I recorded real instruments.
で、シーケンサーはその頃から、マッキントッシュとかも使って、います。で、シーケンサーはデジタルパフォーマーを今使ってましたね。ソフトウェア音源は、まあ、コンタクトとか、マッチ5、アイボリーっていうピアノ音源。
I was using a Macintosh then with sequencing software called Digital Performer and combined that with other software sound sources such as Kontakt, Mach 5, Ivory, a piano sound source, and Trilogy for the bass sound source, etc.
またハードウェアではコルグの、トライトン、ラック、ローランドの JV2080、JD990、EMU の、EMU 使ってたかな?使ってないかな?もう、EMU の E6400、Proteus 2とかね、そういうのをいろいろ駆使して使って作りました。
And the hardware I used for this was a Korg Triton rack, a Roland JV2080, a JD990, an EMU-E 6400, Proteus 2, and various other equipment.
で、そのためにちっちゃい、ノートみたいなのもいつも持ってて、
はい、
電車の中でも歩きながらでも書けるようにしてるんです。
When composing the music for any game, my approach hasn't changed, and this carries on from what I said earlier. I constantly write down and gather ideas or melodies on staff paper. It's like this little notebook that I always keep on me and open up whether I'm on the train or just walking around.
で、それからそれを見て、書いたらその後ピアノとか、ギターを弾きながらとかでどんどんどんどん曲を形を作っていきますね。でとにかく手で書く。煮詰まった時は散歩をして歩きながらどんどんメロディーを歌いながら考えていきます。
And after that, I sit down at a piano or grab a guitar and, you know, go over my notes and try to shape that melody into something. But it always starts by writing it out by hand.And then sometimes I'll just, you know, go take a walk and think about the melody. But yeah, I always start writing it by hand and then think about it or sing during a walk.
Wow, that's really cool to hear that, that, you know, detailed of a process for, you know, you personally is just really cool.
Well, that's a talent, you know, being able to just write stuff out in staff paper and have the melody in your head. I mean, this clearly a talent that I do not have or a skill that I do not possess. So it's just fascinating to me that, you know, you could just...write something out on paper and then just hum it and evolve it into some, you know, beautiful masterpiece.
Right.
That's incredible. So earlier we asked about your influences, but were there any other game composers that may have had a strong impact on you or any just composers that you like in general?
あの、他のゲームの音楽とかをなるべく聞かないように僕はしてるんです。それはね、本当に影響を受けてしまっていつの間にかこう出てくる音楽が例えば誰かの曲に似てるとかいうのはちょっとまずいからね同じゲームの中で、
Honestly, I try not to listen to other game composers if possible. If I hear something, it brushes off on me very quickly, so I'm afraid that it'll affect something I'm working on. It would look really bad if something I wrote sounded very close to someone else's work.
No, I could totally see that. We've heard other composers mention that as well, but for me as a visual artist, I do the same thing. I kind of limit my exposure to other people's work, so I don't want to, you know, soak that in unintentionally.
Right.
なので、そうそう、なるべく聞かないようにとか、遊んででもちょっとで終わるようにしてるんだけど、でもやっぱりスーパーマリオとかね、ドラゴンクエスト、日本ではやっぱドラゴンクエストが有名で、で、そこら辺の曲はもう随分聴いちゃったんで、相当影響は受けてると思います。逆にね、僕、ファイナルファンタジーは全然やってないから知らないんです。
Yeah, so I don't listen. But I also try to play games only in small spurts. Seriously, I'm probably still affected by Super Mario or Dragon Quest music to this day. And actually, I've never even touched Final Fantasy for this very reason, so I have no idea how it sounds.
Yeah, I guess we wouldn't want another Ease Chris Hulsbeck moment.
Right.
So out of all the music that you've composed, if you had to pick a favorite soundtrack, what would that soundtrack be?
本当にね、どの曲も思い出深いし、どの曲も大好きではいるんですよ。
僕と一緒。
だからね、ありがとう。だから一つには絞れないんだけど、例えばルナだったら、はい、そのボードソング、ボードソング、ドゥンドゥンドゥンドゥンドゥンドゥンドゥンドゥンドゥンとか言う、あとオープニングムービーの曲の翼。
Every song is memorable to me in some way, and I like all of it. If I have to pick only one, and we're talking about Lunar, I really like the boat song.And then the song Tsubasa from the opening movie. And I think we actually titled that in English as Wings, which is the direct translation.
日本では Tsubasa っていうタイトルなんだけど。
アメリカでも Tsubasa。
あ、本当？ダラララララララララ。もうこれなんかうちの田舎のね、田舎のっていうのもいいんだけど。その麦がこう、もう育ってた秋ぐらいに、
はい、
麦のがこう風で揺れるでしょ、はい、バーって
そう
あれを見ながらあもしかしたらこんな感じかもしれないって言って作った曲なの
You know, in my countryside, okay, it's kind of weird to say in my countryside, but in my hometown, there's barley fields. And in the fall, when a gust of wind blows, they all kind of sway together. It's a tall grass, so when they move, they all kind of move in formation. And this is the image I had when writing the song.
Oh, that's really cool to hear.
Yeah, it's like this golden ocean of barley, you know.
Yeah.
Brown, and I don't know. That's pretty awesome visual there.
So Iwadare-san has requested that we play one more track while he's on. So would you like to introduce this next song?
Hi. この曲は、ルナ、ハーモニー・オブ・シルバースターより戦いの決意です。
All right, that was Tatakai no Ketsui from Lunar, the Silver Star Harmony, also known in English as Determination, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
Wow, this track is, to me, it definitely feels like a very determined track. You know, some tracks, they don't feel anything like what they are labeled, and sometimes we see that those are just labels slapped on by some marketing team, but to me, it felt like that because it's not very high and not too low, and it's, you know, still really grand, but it's not sad and not really quite happy either. It's kind of in this middle ground where, you know, to me, that kind of feels very determined. Like, you know what you have to do, and you have to do it. You may not like it, but it's not really that bad, I guess. I don't know. It's this track, to me, really spoke to that, and it was also showing how versatile that Lunar theme actually is.
I was going to say the same thing. It's very interesting because this track is so explosive and so energetic, and then it brings that very slow, kind of passive, graceful theme back into the track, and it still does it in a new way. So it's interesting. I really liked the drum kit. It feels like there's like 8 people playing drums, like different instruments, you know,
yeah,
percussion instruments. But that theme, again, is just so soft and so delicate. But at the same time, the background, the woodwinds and the strings and stuff kind of build up and flourish and add so much extra oomph to the track. They give it more determined feel. So that's really awesome. Iwadare-san, tell us your thoughts and why you wanted to play this track.
これはね、ゲームの後半で、その主人公のアレス君が自分の意思で戦うぞっていうことを思って、ね、ルナを助けに行くっていう気持ちをすごく強めてからの、曲なんだけれども。
So this is in the latter half of the game. And this song kind of represents the hero Alex fighting by his own will to save Luna while he's kind of building up all this strength and emotion inside.
彼の、なんていうのかな、そう、行くぞっていう決心の、もうずっと思いながら、さてこのメロディーを使ってどうやって表していこう。 と思って、やっぱこうリズムとかをつけながら一生懸命考えた曲ですね。
He has a strong will to fight on, and so playing with the melody and adding rhythm, I thought really hard on this.
僕も大好きな曲ですし、うん、みんなも気に入ってくれたらとっても嬉しいです。
I really love this track a lot, so I'm happy that others liked it as well.
Oh, that's really awesome. I mean, that's definitely a better way of putting what I was trying to get across earlier.
Right. This track is a fan favorite, and so I'm glad it's kind of towards the end of the show. You know, we really get to like kind of showcase it while we have Iwadari-san on with us. It's excellent.
Yeah, we didn't pick to put it in.
Yeah. We were going to put it somewhere else maybe, but he was like, we're going to play this track. So
right.
Worked out really well. Anyways, Iwadari-san, thank you so much for joining us and telling us about your experiences working on Lunar, the Silver Star, and the remakes, the Silver Star Story Complete. We had a blast talking with you, and just respect everything that you've done for video game music over the years and continue to do so.
Yeah, and like Lunar, this will be an interview that has touched us and we will never forget.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Anyways, we have a few more tracks to play before we wrap up here. Both are from the Sega CD version. So this first one is called The Tower, and we'll be right back.
You just heard The Tower, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare for the Sega CD version of Lunar.
This is towards the end of the game. It's towards the end of the episode and towards the end of the game. This is Galleon's, I want to say it's like Galleon's tower or his fortress or something like that. So this is kind of leading up into like that ending climax. And there's, you know, a lot of like despair and like anxiety. Having that just kick and beat really gets the blood flowing and gets your heart pounding, and you know there's something crazy, you know, coming up soon.
Oh yeah, I mean, and this has a little bit more of that darker feel like you were kind of mentioning, and I think it has more of that rock inspiration that Iwadari-san was talking about.
Yeah,
which was really cool to hear this different kind of song, which was nice, I think.
And to this point we've only heard, you know, like kind of town music, some battle music and stuff, but nothing really like just kind of dark and crunchy.
Right.
So it's really awesome. Let's get into our next track. James, what do we have?
Yeah, so continuing on with this whole wrap-up feel we have going on, the last track is called Final Conflict, and it's also from the Sega CD version.
That was Final Conflict from Lunar, the Silver Star on the Sega CD.
You can see that this track definitely builds off that last one. It's a totally different style. This one's much more classical. I could see it being played for the ending of like a big theater production where like a battle between good and evil, and people are running back and forth across the stage and struggling and fighting in a very exaggerated way. But I really like this track. It definitely brought up a lot of like feelings of like battle and being tense and not sure if you're going to make it type thing.
Yeah, I really like the dun, 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 dun. I thought that was so cool. It feels like a classic bad guy.
Right.
You know what I mean? And that maybe that that 70s rock influence kind of, you know, came into the picture there. I'm not sure,
yeah.
But really, really awesome piece of music. And just what an incredible episode talking about this game. Brings back so many memories. It's such a great experience to go through and learn about the characters, you know, enjoy the story, see how they kind of developed and kind of develop along with them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, this has always been a huge game for you and a bunch of our friends. So it was really great to not only do this episode, but to get to talk to the man that made the amazing music behind all that emotion that this game has.
And this game would not have had the same emotional impact, I think, on people without this music.
Right.
Just, it wouldn't have had the same feel. It wouldn't have been the same. So it was excellent having him on, talking to him about his experiences. But also, we were very lucky that we had a composer do something so wonderful for this game. So and also, thank you guys for sticking through this insanely long episode.
Yes. Yeah.
We put way too much music in here.
Well, it hasn't been since the beginning of doing this show that we've had episodes this long. So.
Yeah. So I guess you guys can forgive us this time. Anyway, so today we covered Lunar on the Sega CD. We also talked about the PlayStation version, a little bit about the Saturn, ignored the GBA version because it was so bad.
Right.
And then we talked about the PSP remake as well, composed by Noriyuki Iwadare.
And if you want to know more about the show, you can check us out online at pixelatedaudio.com for show notes and track lists. And we can be found on all the major social media at Pixelated Audio.
Yes. And if you guys would be so kind to leave some feedback or reviews on iTunes, that's appreciated. Also, we launched a Patreon like a few months ago, and it's been going really well. So we want to say thank you to all of our current patrons. And if you want to throw a few dollars our way, if you like the show and it's important to you and, you know, you like what we're doing, then by all means, go to patreon.com/pixelatedaudio, or you can find the link on our website.
Yeah, and if you just happen to stumble across us for the first time and this is your first episode, you might want to check out some of our past episodes like Aromano no Kiseki for the Famicom Disk System. We also had our Music Disk Volume 2 come out, and we did a really fun 90s PC-themed expansion pack with our friend Gene.
Yes. It was a lot of fun, and
yeah.
A lot of people really liked what Gene had to say, so hopefully we can get him on a lot more frequently.
Yeah.
I think that'd be a lot of fun. He has another, you know, take on music that kind of complements what we like, so I think that us three together can have a lot of fun doing expansion packs and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Anyways, do want to give a shout out to Kirby, our latest patron. Thanks a lot for your donation and your support for us and the show.
Yeah, we really appreciate it.
Yep. So, the track taking us out, we have one last track, a last track of the day. We talked about the Lunar Silver Star Story Complete and that it came with a bundled CD soundtrack.
Right.
So, this track is Lunar Theme Arranged, and this is basically the ending credits for the game. It's a fabulous track, and we think you guys are really going to enjoy it. Thank you so much for listening, and we'll see you back in a few weeks for the next episode.
and you are listening to Pixelated Audio.
はい、本当にありがとう。
もう一回、もう一回、もう一回、もう一回、もう一
回。もう一回、もう一回。はい。
どう ?OK。OK です。
はい、ありがとうございます。
いや、こちらこそありがとうございます。本当に僕も楽しかったです。